Hi. We're here for another Brodeo. Yay! Was that chipper?
That's a different intro for you.
Yeah, I wanted to be a little more chipper this week. How'd that work?
High energy. I like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah.
It's exciting.
Enthusiastic. That's what we are here at OneUp.com. This is Jeff Green, editor-in-chief of the PC side of things, and I'm here with a full room of Brodeo-osity
here. Advanced
Brodeo-osity.
Should we do the little rounds here? We have two special guests, one who's never been on before. However, he was going to be on the day that our magazine shut down.
So be very afraid.
Yeah.
True.
So thanks for that.
Forgot about that.
But should we let them introduce themselves?
Yeah, just go on, guys.
Yeah, let's just do it.
This is Julian Murdoch.
Hi, Julian. Julian is one of the hosts of Gamers with Jobs, a fine, fine podcast.
Well, thank you for saying so, sir. One that you've actually been on.
Those are my favorite episodes
of your podcast. We blame you for all of our success.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's Ken Levine who's responsible for your success.
Probably.
Yeah. Also on today are...
Ryan Scott.
Robert Ashley.
Sean Elliott.
Hi.
Hello.
So Robert and Sean, you guys were at a protest today.
Well, we didn't, you know, we woke up today and we were like, today we're going to end this war. So we met up with our fellow compatriots near the Ubisoft office in South Park.
Are we allowed to say that? Are we allowed to say the word Ubisoft here at Ziff Davis now? Yeah, we can.
Give me a break.
Come on.
We can't say Ubi or soft.
The protesters would agree with that.
Yeah.
So they all gathered together to protest America's army. And at first the message was that America's army is, you know, it's developed by the United States military industrial complex, and it's actually used to start recruiting people under 17 against a certain UN protocol and other things. And then it kind of became like this game is just bad in general, the fact that like the government's sponsoring a game. And I mean, well, there's like mixed messages, right? At any protest there's multiple voices, and there was organizers, and then the guy organizing it was like, I mean, he was really level-headed and articulate, but then some of the other people that came up, it's kind of like just looking for a cause, you know.
They weren't saying the game was bad, like the game mechanics are bad.
I was about to say,
well, that would have been.
Did they post a review?
Well, but
these levels are shit!
This was the joke, because it's like the whole time we still have their like chants in our head, and some of them were like, Ubisoft, shame, shame, war is not a game.
Good God!
War is not a game.
Good God!
Everybody now.
Wow, it's a funky protest.
Well, during the good God part, actually, it was like a little cowbell thing.
Did they really go good
Because they had drums. No, it wasn't good God, but, you know, it's like this little cowbell riff.
Did they bring, like, Frankie Goes to Hollywood out of retirement?
No. But they did all kinds of songs. Like, it started out with, like, a singer-songwriter guy and this and another guy with an acoustic guitar, like, singing songs about closing down the junior ROTC. You know, because there's a big thing in San Francisco against recruiting
kids. My question, I mean, they're just protesting this game now. These games have been around for a long time.
Yeah.
Why did they just pick now to start?
I don't know.
I was going to say, is there like a new release out there? They released a new map pack.
Well, and the funny thing was they sent their like representatives like storming into Ubisoft, and the whole thing was like while we were watching all the music and people talk, was waiting for them to come back from Ubisoft and tell us, you know, what they found out on their mission to like deliver to Ubisoft their message. And they came back and they're like, well, they basically agreed to stop making the game because I guess they're not going to make the game anymore anyway.
Wow.
I mean, that was sort of the message.
Most effective protest ever.
Yeah.
Before we get to that part, I wanted to follow up though, on the music thing.
Yeah.
It was like then they had like the open mic chant, and then this one guy gets on it, and you go from these like really
– open mic chant?
Yeah, like someone just basically like leads, you know,
sounds
does the
like
cheerleading. And one guy got it, and his like maneuver was no justice, no peace. We can't be selling games that promote war in the Middle East. Like it was suddenly introduced like, you know, 15 more syllables than it needed. But I was saying it was like an afterthought. Like we went there not knowing how we were going to cover it, whether or not it was going to be like Daily Show type coverage of Code Pink in Berkeley, you know,
right,
protesting the recruiting station there, or if we were going to go and get a serious look at it. And like we ended up just we ended up really like having it determined for us, because for the most part it was like highly scheduled. There's very little opportunity to talk to people. But if it was a comedy thing, what I would have liked to have done is grab the mic and like start a chant about how the game's graphics are like last gen, or like
right,
the core gameplay is like
we could have taken a few more digs at Assassin's Creed while we were at it too. rub it in.
The strange part about it was, one of the things that they were sort of protesting was that the game isn't realistic enough. So it was almost as if
they're
whole thing was like, well, you know, this is a game about war, but you're not like killing civilians.
They had
and families, which was kind of weird, because it's like, well, it's a training game. I don't think the army really wants to train you to kill civilians,
right,
per
but
se.
But you should have introduced them to GTA 4 if they really wanted to go for that.
Right. Interesting. They had a pair of former servicemen who were dishonorably discharged for, like, coming to, you know, basically protesting against the war, petitioning against it while being enlisted.
Conscientious objectors.
But then they were, you know, listing. They're like, you know, the game will actually have a mission that's based on like nuclear artillery training, and he's like, you know, the guy's like, well, it shows you the fun part about this, but it doesn't, you know, it doesn't take into account that, you know, there's the equivalent of a canary in a coal mine where someone has to pull their mask. You get like the most expendable guy in the unit to take his mask off first, and all these other things, and it just, of course, the atrocities we've talked about them before too, and the way that war games are really, you point stuff and shoot it, and until now, I think David Jaffe's been talking about wanting to make a war game that includes some of those elements where, like, there are civilians, and you have to decide. There are people who want to surrender themselves, and do you fire on them, or do you take them? And so just acknowledging all that, yeah, and saying that it's a bloodless game that, they were to the point where they were upset that the game basically talks up like the quality of like the PXs and just like how nice it is.
One of the guys who had been a conscientious objector, that was his big thing. Like, he got up and, you know, everyone was like really happy to see someone in the military come up and speak, and he was not exactly so enthusiastic as the rest of the crowd. He's like, yeah, you know, I guess this game pisses me off because, you know, I played it, and you go into the hospital and the nurses are all just talking about the quality of the PX and all the facilities and stuff. And I was like, that's bullshit.
I couldn't even get Playboy in there. I had to sell for maximum.
Yeah.
did you get the sense that any of these people had really played the game, or did they like download it, fire it up, and then complain?
One clearly hadn't. An old lady we interviewed, she was like, it's one of those first games, by which she meant first person shooters. She's like, it's one of those first games. And what I think that means is it puts you right in it and you go crazy like Rambo. But then the main guy, the guy who organized the event, was very knowledgeable of the game. It was clear that he had played it and knew, you know, all about what was in it.
Yeah, I mean, you could tell there were definitely like layers of people there. I mean, there were some people there who were really organized and on topic and like not politically insane. And then there are all these sort of hangers-on and weird folks that come out because of San Francisco anti-war
protests.
Right,
there's like going to be tribal drumming. And
yeah.
And
yeah.
They're going to sell
there was tribal
Thai
drumming.
Chicken strips.
Just for the hell of it. Although
veggie burritos.
The most interesting and sort of out-of-control part of the whole thing was when we were still in the park before they marched to Ubisoft, like this kind of drunk in the middle of the day veteran shows up in the park and starts screaming at everyone. And it was really
at them.
Yeah, like he interrupted. What were they calling themselves?
Toothless old women. They were called the Raging Grannies.
The Raging Grannies. Yeah,
because they were singing.
That would be a great band, man.
Raging Grannies.
It's not all it's cracked up to be.
They were singing this like nursery rhyme about, you know, keeping kids away from war. Meanwhile, this drunk guy is like screaming at the audience. He's like, "But what about me? You guys say no war, but I come home and nobody gives a shit about me." And he's like going off, and everyone you could tell was really uncomfortable, because that's the sort of the weak spot for every war protester is the veteran who comes up and says, yeah, these people don't really give a shit about me, you know.
Right.
But he was pretty insane, and the funny part was he just sort of kept on talking until he started like digressing into talking about how he wanted to kill George W. Bush, and he's like, you can quote me on that, I'll shoot him, and like all this insane stuff.
Call the Secret Service.
Oh, man.
It sucked that he was so incoherent, because the one, you know, valid point that he sputtered in between all the other insanity was that I had no choice. When he enlisted, he didn't enlist because he played some hot game, but because he was in a shitty position in life, and that was one of the few viable options that he thought he had. You know?
Yeah.
And that's like something that they're not addressing. But it was like, but then immediately it turned into him screaming about Jews and about killing George Bush. And like, it was really awkward. Yeah. Everyone gathered around immediately, though. All the press that was there just like flocked on that guy.
Oh,
like, oh shit,
course.
Here's our suit.
Right.
Yeah, right. Here's our action. It's like,
it was funny.
Grannies were so boring.
It was funny to see how many people were there from game sites and stuff.
Oh, really?
Like everyone was tuned into it.
It's a blog orgy.
Yeah, and you could tell that like the anti-war people were sort of like surprised by how many people showed up with cameras and stuff.
Yeah.
They're like, wow, we really, you know, found the pulse with this one.
Yeah.
And it's all a bunch of like video game nerds hanging out with cameras like smirking.
The other thing that was awkward about it was like when the couple reported back from having, you know, talked with Ubisoft. They were, you know, they're like, you guys, they handed out all these stickers that are basically like Surgeon General's warning for playing this game. And they were like, at first they're encouraging you to go through all the stores that sell the game in the area and sticker the games, you know. But then they're like, I'm not saying this week they treated us nicely, so you can put the stickers on the street posts and stuff in the area. It was all like very like wink, wink, nudge, nudge, mm-hmm. put that motherfucker all over their front door. And of course, they march down the street. And the first thing you see, the Ubisoft's front doors are just covered in these stickers now. And the guy was bragging about how hard the stickers were to remove, too. Before he went there. He's like, these are industrial strength, man.
And the stickers were like, warning, this game may cause death and guilt or something. It was like this long...
It was weird to see their perspective too, because when they described even walking into the Ubisoft lobby, I mean, we all here know that they have like a Sam Fisher statue in that lobby, and they described it like it was like a fucking Gestapo statue or something. You know, we walk in this door and there's just this really creepy, really scary kind of like this statue, this like, you know, uber military man statue, and the people in there have got these buttons on and they're just really creepy. That was like how they described everything. Like,
yeah,
I understood again that it, like what they were referring to in this case was Ubisoft's got a logo for Ghost Recon and it's like a silhouette of a guy with a gas mask holding an MP5 or something, and like, you know, to them that this was more like, this was like SS button lapel pins or something.
It's just funny that like knowing that the lobby at Ubisoft is designed to make any like 18-year-old man who walks to the door go, oh, awesome. Uh-huh. And meanwhile, like any war protester goes in there and goes, oh my God. is this hell?
And all the guys all the people at Ubisoft wearing those buttons are all probably like SF liberals too.
Exactly.
Yeah, they were peeking out the window and it was just all like just another day in San Francisco type scenario.
You get the feeling it was a slow day in the SF protest scene if this is what they chose to do, you know?
Like, well, they were covering their bases, though. I mean, they were like, they had someone there. They were commemorating the 63rd anniversary of bombing of like Hiroshima, and then they were talking about you know, the ROTC, like, you know, in the same capacity that it's recruiting minors. And I mean, they had all bases covered. People were handing out some flyers about voting for them and for like protesting like Muni. It's just like, you know, municipal transportation in San Francisco. So it was like it's like a protest fair.
And yeah, they had like two or three elected officials there, which I was really surprised by. Mm-hmm. And like a couple of people from the school board. Mm-hmm. There was somebody there running for like city supervisor of the district that Ubisoft is in. And I was really surprised by his balls. He's like, we love video games.
Yeah.
We love the high tech industry. But could you please make games about peace?
Right, My Pretty Pony, Volume 4.
Well, you could tell he was taking a big risk there. I think he was speaking to the wrong crowd, maybe.
Right.
So, yeah.
I have a story I've been wanting to tell you guys ever since the moment it happened, and I had no appreciative audience. And that was when I was flying to Dallas-Fort Worth for QuakeCon last week. And on the way there, a guy in the middle seat is a 74-year-old guy, and he's like taking up my armrest, and at first I was like, oh, like this is going to be fairly horrible. Thank God it's not that long of a flight. And then we start talking, and he says, you know what? He basically portrayed himself as like, you're sitting next to like a pillar of wisdom, and it's going to be idiotic of you to sit here and not like learn from me. So I was like, fuck it then, you know, I'm going to learn right now. So I start talking to him, but then I started to regret that because he was spitting on me the whole time. So I took my blanket and put that over my arms. And so the important thing here is I want to say he was a 74-year-old black man. The only reason that the detail there matters is because you have certain assumptions about the kind of conversations you're going to have with people. It's very natural when you sit down with someone. This is going to be the range of our discussion. And in his case, I was just thinking, like, he's going to be thinking that the world has gone to hell in a handbasket, very much like my dad, you know. Like, I mean, he did. But in between all the insanity, in between him telling me that I would be stupid to marry a woman who's not 9 years my younger because I'm going to continue to get hard-ons and want sex, you know, and that she's going to dry up and hit menopause and all this other detail. Then it turns out he starts talking about playing chess online. And so I was like, okay, listening to him, and he's way into chess. And the next thing he says, he's like, you know, he's like, I go on there and there's a lot of really good people. He's like, and they talk a lot of trash sometimes. And he's like, so what I do to those fuckers? He's like, I turn on that Pogo and I turn on this other computer I have, and it's got Chessmaster 3000
cheats
on it.
Oh my God.
And these guys, then I start talking shit on them. They put in a move. He's like,
oh,
I put the move in the Chessmaster. Chessmaster puts out the move, I put it back in on them. And he's like, they start screaming at me and yelling.
Oh my God.
He's a 74-year-old chess troll?
Yeah, dude.
Holy
shit. And I was like, awesome. I was cracking up, and like, I was like, that's totally amazing. But I couldn't tell him, like, I couldn't say, well, you know what, I pretty much, like, I totally, like, condone this because I do the equivalent of it. It just went, like, I could tell. I mentioned, I was like, well, that's funny because, you know, I work in games and stuff, and I could tell, like, right away, like, it just wouldn't register. So I was like, that's a great story, man. But so that was pretty cool to find, like, a 74-year-old griefer on my flight.
That's a great idea, actually.
And he tells
Never
people,
thought of doing that.
He plays so much, and he tries. It's just like, it shows you how universal this thing is, right? You know, in RTSs, we always talk about Smurf accounts. You go in, and you don't want to have stats that say you played 10,000 games because no one's going to join you unless they played 20,000 and they'll kick your ass. So he has these really high stats, but he doesn't know how to make a new account or whatever the way it works. So what he does is he goes in and he tells people that he's playing in prison and that everyone in the prison shares the same account, shares the same fucking
what
computer.
An elaborate story.
That's hilarious.
It was awesome.
He's a determined 70-year-old gafer.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, I was like, I'm like, I think that's wonderful, man, that you're using your brain like that and that you're on, you know, you're not deterred from playing online games. And
but that kind of crap is rampant. I mean, in poker, in online poker, it's like a serious problem. You get four people who are colluding in instant messenger.
Yeah. Right.
Happens all
right.
the time.
I'm not surprised. I mean, even in the most casual shit I've played, like Yahoo Cribbage and Ticket to Ride is another one back when that was just an online, free online game. There was as much like griefing and people yelling and arguing in chat as in Counter-Strike.
Yeah,
it was like amazing to me.
Yeah,
like I remember like being ganged up on by two dudes in Ticket to Ride. You know, and this is like the most casual fucking game. You know, I just was on it just to waste time, and I realized after a while that these two guys were totally teaming up against me behind my back.
But it's a game about railroad tycoons, right?
But it's every man for himself.
Very accurate.
It's not a team thing.
Yeah, but even if it's even, but same thing with the real tycoons. I mean, on the face of it, yeah, it's every man for himself.
They're just following.
So they were
following
the spirit of the 19th century railroad barons.
Yeah,
is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
So therefore, it's not griefing.
Yeah,
you just need a Teddy Roosevelt to show up.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean that it's crazy how that behavior is not limited to like hardcore gamers. It's like everywhere.
Everybody wants to cheat. I mean, everybody from the day that they learn how to play Monopoly and they're 9 years old starts figuring out that if I play Banker, I can just pull those 500s off the top.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I just watched a Seinfeld last night where, do you guys remember this one where Kramer and Newman are in the middle of a risk game? And they have to put the board in Jerry's apartment because they're worried that one of the others is going to cheat the whole episode. They're both trying to break in to move the risk pieces.
Yeah. Well, that's the ultimate fist fight game, though. Risk.
Risk.
Golf scores, I'm sure, the same way. You know, like I seem to recall and read about, you know, surveys of people like getting to admit that they like that they fudge their scores at the.
Oh, sure. Isn't that rampant? Like golf cheating? Like, yeah. It's like kicking the ball.
But then you're
bit,
like cheating against yourself. That's what I don't get. I mean.
Not if there's money on
well,
the line.
Well, yeah,
if
there's money
with somebody
on the line,
else.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, that guy was cheating against himself, too. He's, like, not learning from Chessmaster.
Yeah,
it's about the dignity.
So do you think he could beat them without – I mean, did he make it seem like he was really good?
He was pretty good, but he acknowledged that there's, like, just an enormous, like, range of skill levels and that there are people on there that would whoop him up. And, like, so that's why he would come back. He'd challenge him to a rematch, you know, and said, like, you know, I wasn't thinking straight. Or, like, he would do the thing, too. That was my – that was the other guy in this other cell. Like, now it's my turn.
Yeah.
You know, like, now I'm going to roll you.
What was the deal with the new? Have you guys heard about this new like hip hop themed like chess community site started by RZA? Yeah.
Yeah, I've heard about it, but I haven't really
like that. I heard some like on the media story about yeah. it where it's like, you know, it's supposed to be social networking and playing chess with people, but it's hip hop themed.
Hey man, if it works with Scrabble, right?
Yeah, I thought it was a weird project, but I ought to check that out.
As long as it's got like a audio player.
Jillian, were you a Scrabulous player?
I was not a big Scrabulous player. I'm a big online chess player, but okay. I wasn't a big Scrabulous player. But I played Scrabble online, like actual, like official legal Hasbro put a crucifix over it and said it was okay.
Right.
But the new version seems like it might actually be a better game. Like,
is that right?
It seems like they've twisted it a couple ways, which make it more interesting because Scrabble's pretty freaking boring.
Now, what is it called now?
What was Scrabulous?
Do you guys know about this controversy?
Did you follow this? Yeah, where they took it down, and then like a couple of days later, they showed up with some like slightly modified.
Yeah, they changed some of the rules, and they changed the name to like Word Scramble or Word.
Yeah, and then the day that Scrabble went online officially in Scrabulous's place, that got hacked and shut down. So by angry Scrabulous players or something.
Everything online is drama, man. People get fucking worked up about Scrabble. That's ridiculous.
Well, it's somewhere ridiculous and getting worked up about WoW. I mean, if it's what you're killing your time with.
I guess.
Right.
I've seen crazy crap all week. Like another thing at QuakeCon, we didn't have a camera and it sucked because I totally wanted to capture it. It's like way late at night and it's like 100 degrees and insanely humid in Dallas. All the people from the convention go out to this grass like bowling green. And they all throw their shoes into this big, enormous pile in the middle. And then they all start spinning around. And the idea is
You're making this up.
I'm dead serious. You know? So we walk up, and half of them were wearing the shame tarp, which was even better because I was like, we could have shot a scene. It was like, who the fuck throws their shoes in a heap and then, like, charges it after making themselves dizzy? It's like, oh. Like, you just all you have to do is just pan, the, like, the backs, and it'd be like, shame, shame, shame. But so they did this.
Explain the shame tarp for people here.
The shame tarp, oh, yeah. So it's time to pimp it. Like, I recommend you check a couple of videos we put there, like, video walking tours of QuakeCon. And the shame tarp is just this, like, a very large shirt, and then it has, like, a picture of, like, a gamer. I don't know. You guys have seen it. You can describe it, maybe.
It's like a wanted picture, sort of.
Yeah.
Or a lineup picture.
With, like, your little brother or something wearing, like, a wife beater.
He looks like an extra from The Fast and the Furious with some, like, driving gloves on, trying to look tough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then what's the slogan on it? Like, you know.
Gamer for life.
Gamer for life. Sorry.
So then they threw their shoes in this pile, and then, of course, then they all ran in there and, like, it was just the stupidest thing I ever seen.
Did they like? Did they actually like start beating the crap out of each other? Because that I could understand if they actually got in there.
There was such a mass of bodies that I couldn't tell. I know whoever was in the middle was probably getting like wrecked, and then some of them were really drunk and they were kind of hanging around the perimeter. And then they would take shoes, they'd sneak them real quick, and then grab them and hurl them like far away. Like out, you know, out into the bushes and trees and stuff. And then they started throwing more shoes onto the mob of people. So people were getting hit in the head with shoes that were
totally
making
I missed a detail here. What exactly were the people in the mob doing?
Trying to get their shoes. Because they had all thrown them into this big center of this ring, of this circle they formed, and then someone, like, raked them all together.
Was this, like, an opportunity
pile.
To get exercise in what was otherwise a sedentary, sit-your-own-sweat
I'm not following this at all. They took off their shoes and threw them into a circle so they could go get them back.
Okay, imagine 100
Is this, like, a German
Did they at least, like, fight over them? I don't get it.
100 people stand in a circle. They take off their shoes. They throw their shoes into a big pile. Uh-huh. Someone rakes the pile up. So you have to imagine that this is now 200 individual shoes. Then they're all mixed up. It's dark outside. Everyone in the circle spins around until they're dizzy. Someone blows a whistle, and then you run in to try to find your shoes.
This is a Japanese game show?
Yeah. a real bad one.
What would be the motivation for someone to want to participate? Because I just don't see how.
I think you'd hear the rules and just go, fuck
no.
Gonna go do something else.
A lot of people were wandering by and like looking at it and thinking that, but I guess like if you just drink balls all day and.
I mean, these are the same guys that made the PC that was inside the barbecue.
Grill, barbecue.
That was a good one.
Oh, that was.
Yeah. So if you just, I don't know, that's pretty much what happens. But like, they had to wrap the show up. Like, I was surprised they had a lot of people come up and say hi. That like listened to the podcast and stuff, and it was cool meeting everyone. So,
did you have a good time overall at QuakeCon?
Yeah, it was totally fun. I think we made it. We tried to make it fun. You know, I mean,
those videos were great.
If you go just normally for press, I could see how it would be pretty boring because all there is the keynote. On one of the evenings, And then there are
Keynote really 2.5 hours?
A couple interviews. It was 3 hours for the entire thing, which was insane. For one, because I was it outlasted my laptop's freshly charged battery. and also, like, I mean, no, I don't think anyone in their right mind ever has a convention without an intermission for 3 hours. It's just normal. You know, people are going to want something to drink. They're going to want to use the restroom or something, and on it goes. But to John Carmack's the reason that it went on so long, and to his credit, what happens is that everything moves along fairly quickly, but then they open the floor, and he does a question and answer.
And he just keeps going.
He just he has so much to say, but also, I mean, a really admirable trait is, like, there's all these people in that crowd, and instead of just saying, like, hey, you guys have to understand, I can't be up here all night, I can mm-hmm. do 10 questions. He will not stop until he's answered every question.
Wow.
He waits until the audience is exhausted, and then when it gets to the point where it's clear that everyone's asked all their questions, then you get in this weird, like, feedback loop where then they feel awkward, so they're like, shit, we better ask questions.
He's not done. Because he's not getting
off
stage.
And then they keep asking questions, and he keeps answering, and then that's when some of us are like, fuck, come on, man.
Well, but he's also so forthright. I mean, he's mm-hmm. one of those few people that when you ask him, you know, what do you hate, he's going to give you every single line of it.
It's great, too, because there are so few people with that. I mean, it's a combination, I think, of his personality and also the position he's in. There are relatively few people in the business that have that kind of freedom. And so it's fantastic when you do speak to someone that has it. Gabe Newell's another person.
I was going to say, he's the only other person mm-hmm. I can think of, because they both work for themselves, basically.
Yeah, right. And it's nice to just not have to, like, listen to any – I mean, I'm not saying that – I mean, everything's bullshit that we get from other sources, but it's, like, it's just so clear. They're never pausing and thinking about how they want to phrase something that's going to, like, you know, placate the people standing behind them. It's just, like, coming right off of the top of the head. And, I mean, so that's cool to talk to him in that respect.
Yeah, I'd kind of made fun of Gabe on the on my live blog, the EA live blog, about how slumpy he looked, and I guess some people got mad that I did that, and some people who work with him were like, "Did you have to do that?" But the truth is, though, that I actually sort of admired it too, that he just walks on there like, "Yeah, I'm Gabe Newell, and fuck you," you know. Well, I mean, not like that, but just sort of like that he knows he can just do whatever the hell he wants, and
right.
he does.
Will Wright's
you
know? The
and
same
then he's
way
cool.
When
he talks, he's cool.
Right.
And he's totally a genius.
Will
so.
Wright's kind of the same way.
Yeah.
If you see him do like his TED thing, or anytime he stands up with a microphone, he kind of just tells you whatever the hell he wants to tell you.
Yeah.
Although Carmack doesn't come off with quite the same marketing polish that a Will mm-hmm. Wright does, because you always get the sense when Carmack speaks that whatever the last thing he was doing that was really cool is what he's going to talk about, whether it's the right thing mm-hmm. or not. I mean, all the stuff he was talking about, iPhone gaming. It's mm-hmm. like he's only had the thing for a couple of weeks, but he's just like, this is it. This is what I'm doing next. It's going to be great.
He's probably reverse engineered the whole device and reprogrammed it. Like a rocket ship or something.
A lot of the questions were about that. Were about his, his various stuff in rocket science. So I mean, it was interesting. There were people talking about space diving, which is essentially now people want to take the rockets that Carmack and some of the others that have been working on these various programs have developed, and basically create a suit that allows you to ride the thing up and then basically come back down,
jump off
from the highest possible before you leave the atmosphere,
Or you could just strap the rocket to your chest and let it explode.
Yeah.
Probably feels about the same.
And the funny thing, too, is he's like, who would want to do this? He's like, there's a line, I mean, there's actually a line of people waiting to pay to do it. Mark Rain's another guy, I think, who fits in that camp of having the freedom. And then I was thinking as we were talking, I was like, lately, more and more, Dennis Dyack's in there. But it's like, I think for some people, he epitomizes where it can backfire to some extent on someone.
Well, because
I have nothing against, but I mean, just talking strictly outside of my own perspective, public response to some of his recent commentary, mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I think he wades in a little too deep. There's
right,
a big
difference. Yeah.
Big difference between sitting here and saying, I'm developing, here's why the 360 is really a better platform than the PS3, which is one of your interviews with Carmack, he was going off on. And the stuff that Dyack's been talking about, which is really just as much sort of wading in hip deep and stirring up shit.
And it's also kind of more self-serving and defensive about his own stuff, as opposed to just sort of talking about the industry itself.
Yeah, I think that's it. Like, nobody wants to see someone have to get down to the level of defending themselves to any random person on a message board.
Right.
It's like, oh, don't do that. You don't have to stoop down.
You
made this thing. Let it speak for itself. You shouldn't have to write message board posts to defend your game. Your game should speak for itself.
That's how David Jaffe is.
Yeah, he's a little bit less wacky about it. But yeah, I'd say so.
He has a blog.
He does have a blog.
It's entertaining.
He does have a blog. Me and Ryan are having a moment right now, staring into his eyes. You have the most beautiful slate blue eyes.
That's what people tell me.
I never noticed.
You'd be shocked. See, you know,
we talk about games. We go to protests. We don't take the time to sit and just get to know each
just
other.
Stare into my eyes.
Yeah.
Tell me about your childhood.
Okay.
Wow.
Do we have any, now that you're on the spot, we have any Ryan Scott moments?
We just had one. It was electrifying.
I'm in a cold sweat over here after that.
Now I'm on the spot now.
What have you been doing? You played Soul Calibur Online yet?
I did.
Yeah? How'd that go?
It went well. Out of about 40 matches, there were only a couple that...
Played a lot?
Yeah, well, over the past few days.
Cool.
There were only a couple matches with any noticeable lag, so I'm kind of in your camp about how amazing it is.
Yeah,
I don't know. There's some people complaining about how online's busted, but I don't know what they're talking about.
When the performance bar is at 5, and that's the max, and it's always that way. I've been, you know, Rory's based in Arizona, and it's always at 5 for him. And when I play him and people in California, it's like perfect. But we've been playing a lot of people in Albany, New York, and it's at 4. And it's totally fine, too. Now and then, there could be a thing where you want to, like, debate the timing of a guard impact or something. But for the most part, it's, like, it's really, like, impressive to me how well it works, you know? And so for that reason alone, I've been waiting for that for the longest time. And
why is it that forever, like, fighting game developers were like, we can't do it. It's impossible. Like,
we've been playing Counter-Strike for decades.
Forever they made it seem like having a fighting game that actually, you know, played decently online was just... out of the realm of possibility, and now it just seems like...
Right. Because every frame counts. I mean, that's been the argument that I've heard, you know, and we understand that why that would be the case, but it's like every frame counts in, you know, in Counter-Strike as well. I mean, if you're playing seriously, it's not like you're going to be like, yeah, that's fine. I can't hit him because of lag. I mean, that's going to piss you off. You're not going to play, you know?
Yeah.
How are the boob physics in Soul Calibur 4?
Next question.
I'm asking because I saw an article on Games Radar.
Why don't
that.
You go read that article?
Yeah.
Well. Good article.
I hear Yoda has killer boobs. That's really what I
hear. Really? He's got killer Yoda boobs.
Are they green?
I guess they'd have to be.
The thing is, they're pretty hairy.
Green hairy
boobs.
He's got three, like, chicken,
Total Recall. Is there
his three hands.
The thing that people don't realize is that for a Yoda between the ages of 200 and 800, he constantly lactates.
Oh, wow. Is that kind of a turn on, though? Is that a good thing?
No.
That's what the hair is. They call it milk hair.
And Yoda milk is really putrid smelling. It turns immediately into this sour sort of yogurt stuff.
Uh-huh. Do they actually animate that? Because that would probably slow down the frame rate.
they went all out.
And we already know every frame counts. So.
Oh, God.
You write a lot of Star Wars fanfic?
Oh, identity revealed. I can't help it. I'm just intrigued by the physical.
Is Yoda hermaphrodite though? Now I'm curious because I know you do read all those novels. Yeah,
He says hey. I mean, they say he about him. So
yeah, he's a guy.
There was that girl.
No,
Yoda
but that was like in one like of the Robert said. Really? I mean, that was like 200 to 600 years ago, not now.
Yeah,
it's like
at the age that Yoda is now, he is now a woman for all.
Maybe so wait, are there female? Yodas?
There was one Yodai on the Jedi Council in episode 1.
There
what
was
her name?
Yes.
Yaddle.
What?
Yaddle.
Yaddle. Says
good Lord, was she smoking hot.
Oh, my God.
Oh. Female Yoda.
So she must
there were like 1,000 podcast listeners all going, Yaddle!
Who's that?
Idiot? Who's that? That's her name. Dumb shit.
Oh, my God.
That's why Star Wars is completely unbelievable. Because if we ever, in the course of humanity, even like tens of thousands of years from now, came upon any race of being that looked like Yoda, we would kill them all. or we would be killed by them.
No.
There's no way we would ever say, like, hey, you want to come to dinner?
Yaddle appeared on the Tyra Banks show, and Tyra gave her an iPod Nano.
to like, and a makeover.
Yeah.
Oh, you look so fine. Oh Lord.
That's an intriguing thought, though, Robert. You might be right.
Yeah.
What would happen
if we ran into
Yoda?
A Yoda.
Uh huh.
Well,
kill
the
on
first
sight. Probably.
Kill on sight.
But they have the Force, and we know nothing. They would just
then they would kill us, but we would not be coexisting. That is a fact. Hmm. Yeah.
We need to find out how that happened, how the first meeting happened. Or has there already been fiction to explain
There's got to be.
There's
I mean,
the Star Trek First
universe.
Contact
There's
series.
Other guys yelling into the thing now.
It's in the book, the 76 book.
I'm really
yes
hoping.
Yes, and more
hoping
will be answered in the KOTOR MMO, right?
Oh, yeah.
Play through this live.
That's right. 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 That'd be awesome. There's a suggestion for a quest line, Bioware.
Yaddle.
Yeah,
and with like a little side story. Branch Yaddle about whether style.
Sexual orientation of the Yoda race.
Yeah, and I need to see some
that.
Stuff about this lactation that I'm interested in.
Another quest line.
Yes.
Right. Get 10 cups of Yaddle milk.
Yeah. Oh, that's just so wrong.
You should come up with a name.
But it's so the thing is, it's so imbued with the power of the Force that even though it's so, it's terribly disgusting. But people come from far and wide to try to drink it and gain the power,
dude.
Of the Force.
Well, now that it has been,
oh my God, I'm done.
Wow. I don't know how we got here.
Oh, I'll stop.
Okay. We got a podcast in tears.
We can go to.
That was a full breakdown. Full podcast breakdown.
Oh my God.
Okay. So no more. Stop thinking of.
Yeah, please. You know, no.
Okay. We'll end that thread.
That's a good one though. Like we should come back to it at some point because it reminds me of Wang Wang. You know, like that whole story. See, look at this fucking hypocrisy. Remember when he was, it was on GFW Radio.
You're right.
When I was telling the story of fucking Wang Wang, which so clearly inspired your derivative rip-off piece of shit Yoda story. And yet you accused me of total fucking insanity, dude. Because I said that Wang Wang got pregnant by sitting in a public toilet.
No, but that's because when you were telling me about that shit, you were telling me like via IM, and you were giving me this long mythology. It's like you were writing the Wikipedia entry about it. And I'm like, what the fuck is this? And there were so many like points. It wasn't just one like lactation.
No, we
thing.
Were in fucking Ventrilo together, dude. We were playing Team Fortress, and Rory was in there. We were both talking, and we were explaining to you. And then he got mad. And he's like, dude, don't try to explain Wang Wang to him. But I'm like, I think he's ready for it.
It's probably because it was like day one of me trying to play Team Fortress, and I was getting killed like every second. Going like, motherfucker, how do I do this?
And then you just keep hearing random stuff.
Like, how? And I think at that time I was like, I don't even know how people
I
manage
think it's
to
fine.
Talk while
it's
they
okay.
play.
We're not gonna. It's not flip flopping. It's just a change in perspective, and that's something to admire. I admire that you've embraced.
I still think Wang Wang's bullshit.
Dude, you can just bring the two together. Like,
all right.
This is kind of a dumb and dumber argument.
Yeah.
Especially because
we'd be
some
slapping each other's heads in a minute.
Everybody know what Wang Wang is.
Anyway.
Okay. So let's go into some serious news.
Right. Actually, I wanted to. Yeah.
On the lighter side of gaming.
Actually, I wanted to ask you about Rage. Well, right.
Yeah. Yeah. What about it?
Did you like it?
Well, I saw the same video that everyone else saw in the trailer, and then I had an interview with Matt Hooper, the lead designer, and from what I've heard, just talking with him, it sounds like a step in the right direction for id. The other thing is that even on the art design front, I think they got someone from Ubisoft.
Yeah.
And it's taking them away from – I mean, id games are id games. They have that certain stamp to them, but I think – it's time. They don't need another Doom, and they don't need another Wolfenstein and Quake. And
thank
so
God.
There's,
yeah.
While there's still monsters, while there's still big guns and things like that, it's definitely different. I mean, you can imagine. And, I mean, when I heard the Ubisoft thing, I'm like, okay, this makes sense. I'm imagining some of their like environmental paintings and things like this. I think that's cool. But everything he's describing, I mean, right? You have to play it in action and see the levels to really know. But it sounds good. I mean, there's like some rudimentary form of an economy in the game. It sounds as though it's not absolutely linear.
What's the basic thing? I haven't read anything about the game.
What we know is This is really weird too. When I talked to Matt, I was surprised that I got as much info as I did, because there's almost like next to nothing known about it, other than that they show these demos and the video clips that they've shown have depicted wasteland like environments, you know, Mad Max type worlds where people are driving these like cobbled together 18
vehicle
cars
craziness.
With guns on them. Yeah. And then they've shown very, very quick teaser clips of monsters, but not Doom monsters, you know, kind of. They got like cleft palates or something, you know.
Right.
But so from the sound of it now, it's this imagine it's Mad Max type world or something, and they're like these ogre-ish mutant type things in it as well. And racing is like the primary form of entertainment. Kind of reminds me of like Star Wars Episode One with the pod racing thing in a way, you know. And in these various cities, they each have their own track or course, and it sounds like you can race there if you'd like, and you can gain sponsorships and things that, you know, will have different stickers and logos on your car, but you also get weapons that you can take out into the wasteland as you're fighting and exploring, and then use them in that capacity. And you can get out of the vehicle anytime you want, and there might be times, as he's describing it, I kept trying to compare it to things that I'm familiar with. So when he said there might be a point of interest you'd want to exit your vehicle and explore, look for some item or respond to a help call, I'm like, well, that sounds exactly like the way that the vehicle segments in Half-Life 2 and its episodes work. And he's like, no, it's not quite like that. And he's like, for the most part, in some sections you don't want to get out of your car, because that's like just about, you know, it equates to suicide because the forces are so overwhelming. So it's like, well, is it like Borderlands, you know? I mean, because cosmetically, that's another game set in this like wasteland, except that's on another planet. And he's like, no, it's not quite like that. And then the most important question I had to ask him was like, please, God, tell me it's not like the vehicle section in Quake 4. And he's like, no, it's nothing like that at all. They're really weird about that because, you know, Raven developed Quake 4. And Carmack's been pretty plain that he is dissatisfied with that game. But then that same studio is making the new Wolfenstein game. And, like, it's always such a point of obvious pride whenever it's like we're internally doing Doom, the next Doom. You know, they're not calling it Doom 4, but whatever it is, we're doing Rage. And it's like, but then they're still trying to pimp the new Wolfenstein game there too. And it's like, it's Raven, but the vehicle segments in Quake 4 were just crap, dude. They're horrendous.
Right. Also, you know, it and Raven go so far back though. You know, Raven isn't just like random third party house to them. You know, they're practically an extension of it. They go all the way back to the beginning. So, you know, I could see why they would still, you know, still have be kind of defensive and protective of Raven.
Did
they comment at all on multiplayer versus single player versus persistence or anything like that?
They would only say, and they would, it was like they wouldn't even confirm. It was like, you know, co-op seems like an obvious thing in here, and it's like, I agree with you, that's like an excellent idea. This is just the kind of game that's perfectly suited for that, and that's about as far as things went.
Okay.
For discussing competitive multiplayer elements for both Rage and the next Doom, Carmack in his keynote repeatedly acknowledged that Doom 3's multiplayer was really insufficient, that it was there, and that they're in this problem. They when you make first-person shooters, there's a sense that you're expected to include a multiplayer component, and what happens then is that you either do a half-assed one, and it kind of backfires, and it detracts from people's like perception of your game, or you go all out, and then you get stuck in the trap where you're basically making like Quake Wars, and that's why they did that on its own, and it's an increasingly... Whatever, despite we know how successful COD4 is and the Halo series and stuff, I mean, at least on PC, he's arguing that it's an increasingly smaller audience that is just purely attracted to the competitive multiplayer aspect of these games. But so what he ended up saying is that definitely more than Doom 3 as far as multiplayer goes, but not not like Quake Wars level of just total commitment to crafting a multiplayer game.
Yeah, it's weird. This genre to me seems one that's gotten like more and more insular over the years, you know, to the point that it's nearly exclusionary, you know, that I just feel like in the old days of Quake and Doom, like we could all play those games and we all did play them. And I'm talking multiplayer, you know, where there would definitely be people who were better than others and there'd be people that would dominate. But now the barrier to entry
I would argue now in your mind should be Quake 2 and beyond. Because seriously, from Quake 2 on, there would be people that like even be able to touch.
Quake 2, when it first came out, I could still play.
Well, but I think there's a difference between the sophistication of players and the sophistication and complexity of the games, right? Yeah. Because part of the problem with hopping into a random TF2 server or Call of Duty or Battlefield is that it's no longer the case that everybody who hops in is at an equal level. Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. You've got unlocks, and you've got... in particular, you've got strategies that are now complex enough and class-based enough mm-hmm. that the idea that you're just going to hop in and be functional in a broad server is just mm-hmm. impossible.
And in the case of Quake Wars, the system itself is prohibitively complicated for some people.
Right.
But so that's one big part of the picture. But then, as Quake Live is already proving so quickly right now, there's also the difference in player skill level. So you take, Quake Live, which is basically a port of Quake 3 that works in a web browser. Very simple game insofar as, you don't crouch, you don't do all that, you don't use cover. You have a jump button, you have the WASD keys, and you have a shoot button. Mm-hmm. And yet, regardless of its superficial simplicity, you go in there now, you will not get a single kill. Like, you will not score a single kill if you're not wise enough to really choose your competition. If you go in against seasoned players,
if you do get a game that's simple enough, and I would argue that TF2 tried to be that simple and has kind of made itself more complex since it launched.
Yeah.
That if you do have a simple enough game, imagine a theoretical game with one weapon, right? Mm-hmm. No additional movement keys, really boring game to play. Then you could at least come up with a skill system where you could say, okay, well, this is my public persona, and I've played enough that I'm at this sort of magic skill level of 100. Mm-hmm. This other person's at 50. The whole true skill thing was supposed to work like that. Mm-hmm. Never really did. But if you make the game simple enough, something like that could work. At least I hope so, because otherwise I'm screwed.
Right. I mean, I think they want that to work for Quake Live as well. I mean, that's just matchmaking is always an issue. And then there's the ability to just gather a group of people that and just because for whatever reason, most of the times, a group of friends, it just seems that their skill level's all fairly,
Well, and even if it's not, if you've got a good community of people, the teams will self-balance. You get five people on a server of 16 that are really good.
Mm-hmm. People who are, insanely good at Quake don't have any real friends.
They do. They're just also insanely good at Quake. I mean, there's whole clans of them.
I'm just fucking with you.
You asshole.
I also wonder, id, I mean, not to diss them at all, but to some extent, they've kind of I don't want to say they've lost a thread. That's too harsh, but they were the authority on this genre, right? I mean, it was them and everybody else. And now it's a more diverse field here. I mean, now they have to contend with Valve, even Bungie on the console side with Halo. I mean,
and I think they're admirers of their competition. I mean, they play their games. Yeah, they're really humble on that front. Mm-hmm. I mean, especially when Carmack speaks, because he's not a designer in that sense.
Right.
He's a programmer. And another point that he emphasized in their keynote was that we don't need any more, genius programmers that are going to come mm-hmm. and help us figure out some graphic solutions. Like, we need level designers, and we need really good ones, and they're really hard to find nowadays. It used to be a time when almost anyone with some degree of experience could make a Doom style level. That's where you're going around through this corridor mm-hmm. and you just make a maze, and you mm-hmm. put enough cheese in this maze to keep you going through it. It could be guns, they could be enemies. And now you want the guys that are making the finest levels in COD 4, the finest levels in Half-Life 2.
It's a total art form.
Right. Really right.
And it's BioShock levels. I mean, so they're saying this is who we're looking for. I mean, there's some humility in that. That's saying, you're id. They've already got their core 90 people that they've had for quite, a long time now. And it's we're open to change. Same thing with getting the art guy, mm-hmm. It's you can imagine. It is also, you could see Carmack was acknowledging there's the history of the company when John Romero was there. And it's when everyone had attitudes, when everyone was we are fucking id, you mm-hmm. don't question our, and I think that whole kind of perspective can be just fatal for any kind of studio mm-hmm. when it's we're just so fucking good. We're not going to listen to anything. We're not going to change anything. It doesn't mean you need to go out and let everyone tell you what to do, but at least to just plug your ears to the entire world and think you're on top. That's how you find out that you're no longer on top, mm-hmm. And Carmack was pretty much saying that, I believe. Mm-hmm.
Garnett did show me some of the art that this guy, this French, I think he's French, the guy they got from Ubisoft, or he's French-Canadian. Mm-hmm. And it did look totally different, some concept art for for Rage, I guess it was.
Yeah, as long as it's not like grotesque, you know, like things with cancer, it's gross, and then like robotic legs and arms, you know, like like, and always asymmetrical.
Well, they have done
one,
that.
They got one arm, but they couldn't afford to work on the other. They're saving it. They're like, you know, like pre-op, like robo sexuals or whatever.
Yeah. What else we got? Is that enough on it and QuakeCon and
that's
all that?
Yeah.
Do we need to take a break?
How we can
doing?
Take a break.
Are we at break? Skip shrugging. And now he's saying yes.
Okay, take a break.
Okay. We'll be back after all these words from all our sponsors.
As for Yoda, Robert, you have a final word on
how we don't have any.
Yoda's milk.
Do a commercial for Yoda's milk since we don't have a sponsor this week.
Yeah.
GFW Radio brought to you by Yoda's milk.
It's delicious.
And we're back.
We're going to hit up some news items. The first thing, though, we checked the internet while we were taking our short break, and we found out that Yoda's lactate comes out like much like paneer, the consistency of Indian paneer. Okay, the second item is from IGN, and here's what I get for like last minute like pressing print on my computer. But so someone named Svensson at Capcom is discussing the future of Capcom's games on PC, and there's no confirmation, it's not certain, but they're expressing some doubt, some hesitancy in continuing to support the PC platform in the way that they have been so far, which has been fairly strong, right? Resident Evil 4 came out eventually on PC.
Eventually doesn't strike me as strong.
But beyond that, Devil May Cry, the most recent Devil May Cry came out fairly soon. The plans are to get the next Bionic Commando out right away. You know, both versions
of that.
What
was the ice game? What the hell was that called?
Oh, yeah, Lost Planet.
Lost Planet. And its special editions came out right away on Steam. So here's the quote. I know that Inafune-san and I are both huge proponents of the PC platform, and Capcom's an active participant in the PCGA. We believe in the future of the platform, and that contrary to what retail data shows, it is growing. Our rosy prognostications aside, somewhere the P&Ls of Capcom's Japan's outings on the platform are going to come up, and they're likely to have a huge bearing on the decision-making process of future titles. That's my long-winded way of saying stay tuned because it's not clear yet. And so what he's talking about there is that P&Ls is like piracy and stuff. And so, I don't know. I mean, quickie news item, but it's just like another – if it's another case of piracy and like shit, that was something else I saw at QuakeCon. A lot of people downloading games.
Yeah, there was a story on 1UP, I think, about the piracy of issues with Devil May Cry 4. Mm-hmm. Or that they had claimed that there was just a shit ton of it going on for the PC version. Yeah,
that sounds like kind of. I think often those like ports like that are often the ones that get pirated. You know, people are just like, I wouldn't normally buy this like Iron Man and stuff like that, but it's like let's try it. And I don't know.
Wait, you saw people pirating games at QuakeCon? Like
yeah,
sitting
if you
there
looked
at their computer
video,
and you're like,
if you've ever been
I'm
to a LAN party, it's like half the reason some people go to LAN parties.
Oh, because they're
taken from each other.
Yeah.
There were people with like 19 hard drives in a single computer. And like, you know,
and they weren't
capacity.
All pictures of Ma.
Yeah.
Well, maybe they were
other people's moms, and it's not their own.
The storage capacity is like, you know, in the terabytes, and it's like
that, the thing is that was Google, and that was Google that you ran into right there. They were at QuakeCon. That was the whole.
That was the Google server in that box. Yeah.
That was all of it.
That was all of the internet.
So, yeah, I mean, it's a fact I know. I mean, there's someone I'm not going to name. It's definitely not – it's not anyone I've ever named in the context of my friends in Ventrilo. But there's someone that's, like, an affiliate of that group who, like, seems to have no concern with pirating stuff. And it's, like, when he pops in, you hear him. He's, like, what are you playing? Like, Iron Man. And everyone first is, like, the fuck? And
yeah,
it's,
you
like, how did pay for it? And we're, like, fuck you. You know, it's, like, because – but, I mean, yeah, I know.
That's
and I know he's, like – I know he's fairly, you know, representative of – a lot of like really hardcore PC gamers.
And that's the dumb thing about piracy though, of like anything at all, movies or games or video games or music. You end up like looking at or listening to or playing things that you would never play or listen to or look at if you were paying. Mm-hmm. So it's like, why the fuck are you doing that? Because it's free.
That's how you're justifying it.
I found it on Pirate Bay.
Yeah.
Like,
that's like a weird mentality. It's like the kind of person who will, like, when my grandmother had this, like, phase where she needed an intervention because I think, like, my aunt went to her house and her bedroom, like, she was sleeping on the couch. And they're like, well, why are you sleeping on the couch? And they go into her bedroom and it's, like, just full of, like, the bed's covered in, like, packages of brand new socks and stuff because they're, like, for sale at Walmart or something, you know?
Yeah.
So it's like this mentality. It's like, well, I can get something for free or for cheap.
Well, you know, it's, like, I mean, I know so many people like that with music that they sit there and say, oh, you know, I've got this 400 gigabyte hard drive is full of music and it's got 50,000 tracks
on it.
Yeah,
how often?
And then they have their 8 gigabyte iPod they haven't changed a song on in 2 years.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah, I found a deadly one for me recently, which is at Amazon. I don't know if you guys have seen this, but they have these daily specials now in their MP3 section.
And there's some good stuff.
And there's good stuff, but it's like as cheap as a dollar. Like today's, it's $1.99 for Rod Stewart's Every Picture Tells a Story, okay? He sucks now. He does. But at the time,
no,
dude,
but
that was a good record.
Is that
they
like
put
Maggie
some,
and
it's
all
a,
the,
yeah,
all,
yeah, it's $1.99. You know, I got Queen's Night at the Opera for $3.99.
Yeah, exactly.
You would have fed on Rod Stewart's
$3.99. It's been like a trip down memory lane. It's been like if you're building a rock and roll collection.
Yeah, and for
endless.
That cheap, it's just almost like impossible for me not to do it because right. I and it's only 24 hours too. It's like, oh, I got to do it. I did that the other day with like it was like Hank Williams' greatest hits. Like
they had
20 songs for $1.99 up until midnight. Like the last 2 hours, I was like, I should buy it. In 2 hours, it's going to be $8.99 again. I should do it.
But
and then I did
some,
it.
And some, but occasionally there's some amazing ones. They had Nebraska, Bruce Springsteen for like $4.
Right.
Like. How can you like music and not at least
it's actually
want
good
to have
stuff.
That somewhere?
That should be like how much MP3s cost, period. Like,
yeah,
paying more than $5 for some fucking files is ridiculous.
Yeah, but to me, it's kind of an evil thing because they have me hooked now. Like, I can't not go there every day. Every day I'm going like, oh, shit, what's Amazon special today? And if it's something half decent, I'm going to buy it.
If you're lucky it's digital or your bed would be covered in MP3s.
I know, that's the thing. And that's another reason why I can justify because it's not another fucking CD sitting at my house, you know. So
yeah.
I think after that,
and your wife can't like come home and be like, "Honey, did you spend a lot of money at the record store?" Because she can see
the Amazon bills because we share the same account, but they're for $1.99. You know,
right? So nobody's gonna say anything.
My wife's full album
books.
Yeah. That's
what
I'm saying.
Albums.
Yeah.
Well, that's about time. I mean, it was like when I was saying before when I was complaining about the prices of, you know, when it took me so long to get The Wire. Because the first season at the time, the price must have come down because it was, like, insanely expensive. And same thing with, like, the war. It's, like, for me, it's, like, eBay is the solution now. Been able to, like, keep getting everything on there. But other than that, it really does. It's almost like there's a point when you're kind of, like, encouraging people that are, like, on the threshold of considering, like, downloading to just do it, you know?
Well, this is to get back to games, this is the thing I have about the whole PC piracy thing is I have never seen particularly good numbers on the impact the rental market has on console sales because of the people I know that are hardcore console players that, you know, just they're always playing something 3 hours every night, hardly any of them buy anything. You know, they're either GameFly queuing or they're going down to the store because they play enough that they're going to finish anything in 2 to 3 weeks unless it's something really epic like Oblivion or something like that. Or
same thing for like the resale market, right? I mean, and these are traditionally, I mean, these are always like being, I don't know. I mean, look at Skip. He doesn't have a microphone. For some reason, I think you know about it. But it seems like the industry is always going after the selling used games and then the rentals and stuff like that.
So, you know, on the PC, there's a bit of a feeling that, okay, well, if I'm going to buy Oblivion for my PC, I'm out $60, right? I'm not giving that to anybody. It's particularly true if it's a multiplayer game. Forget it. You know, you're not going to buy Half-Life 2 and start playing, you know, whatever, Half-Life 2 Deathmatch or something like that, and then hand that game off to anybody and get any money back. So I think there is – I'm not defending piracy by any means, but I think there is a natural tendency for somebody to not do that if they're on the console because, A, it's harder. Obviously, you have to chip your console and all that. But you can also go down the street and try a game for $4.
Yeah. Imagine this. I don't know if this is too far out there. Like, GameTap's not doing so well right now. There was just a recent announcement that they're in some sort of like financial trouble.
Well, and they
killed
all the editorial stuff.
Killed the editorial, but Turner is putting it up for sale now. So
imagine some future though, where there's like, you know, they're increasing like fewer publishers. Say there's EA, there's Ubisoft, Activision, Blizzard, and stuff like that. And it's like they've got the equivalent of HBOs, you know, and it's like you subscribe So it's like I subscribe to EA Online, and that means I get Dead Space, and then, you know, the equivalent of the next season, like getting The Wire.
It's exactly
and
how
all
it
the
should
stuff
work. I mean, the like, GameTap, I understand they've been having problems, but it's been an absolute blessing for a certain category
sure.
of gamers. I mean, if you're an adventure gamer and they're mm-hmm. still out there, you know, I mean, Sam and Max for, you know, your $60 a year plus everything else. Plus, they put Fallout on it. So, I mean,
right.
this whole region of
now
NMA
you can get
guys
Fallout over at Good Old Games,
for
which
like
I don't think we've talked about yet.
$5 or $10, right? Or
yeah.
Like
but, I mean, people have been saying that about, you know, about information downloads in general, like that anything that can be turned into, like, infinitely copyable data should just be sold as a utility, you know, because it just doesn't make any sense to sell it as if it were a physical object.
Right.
You know, you should just
right.
be able to subscribe to content and listen to whatever music you want to or
right.
or read whatever you want to or watch.
Well, I mean, that's basically what getting a Gamefly subscription is, right? You
yeah.
pay your $150 a year or whatever it is by the year, and you get three games, whatever they are. I just want Steam to work that way. I just want to give Valve, you know, write Gabe Newell a big fat check in Sharpie and say, here's my $200. Just give me whatever the hell you
yeah,
came
I wonder
up with this
if, like,
year.
They would have, like, mm-hmm. I mean, they could, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there are some impediments to it, but they could, like, do a test on that, you know? It's like it doesn't
they
have
totally
to be either
could.
Or. They can have both. Like,
they totally could.
Package.
You know, and the guys at Telltale, I know, are really happy with how the deal has worked for them with GameTap, that, mm-hmm. you know, they have a steady income stream that I don't have to worry about selling a box copy of an adventure game at Best Buy,
mm-hmm.
which just strikes
mm-hmm.
me as a losing proposition.
Yeah.
I wonder what's going to happen to them with this GameTap fallout that kind of sucks.
Well, they have other methods of distribution. They have Steam. They've got
yeah,
Impulse.
That's true. Yeah.
And you know,
I guess we just don't know how much of big of the pie the GameTap part was. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. So have you guys seen Good Old Games? It's GOG.com. It is. It's GOG.com.
That's
it's
the CD Projekt?
CD Projekt, the guys who made
GOG
The Witcher.
GOG and Magog.
They have this side.
You know about that?
Set and Magog.
It's biblical. That's
you
prophetic.
You want to tell us a story?
Breakdown. It's just figures from biblical prophecy that herald the Armageddon, the Battle of Armageddon.
I don't think there's any relation.
This is
don't
not
think
the
that's
end of
why
the
CD Projekt.
GOG once
this
Magog
is just
rears
the first
his head.
Step.
Yeah,
and the
so
project
something
out
of Ghostbusters. GOG.
Israel's yeah. a state. We have GOG now, and when Magog appears, we will have Armageddon.
Nice. So it's still in beta, but goodoldgames.com, it's from the CD Projekt guys. This is their side project. I'm just going right past your apocalypse scenario. And they're offering it's kind of GameTap at a step further because you're owning these games. They've got the library of old Interplay games and a library of old Codemaster games to start with. And they're saying they're going to beef up the library by the time they launch. And they're available for download for, you know, pretty butt cheap. And there's some great games like Fallout 1 and 2 is in there.
And they're all patched up, right? I mean, that's the part of the hook is that you can run it on an XP machine, right? You can
that's
get
right.
Fallout.
They're not, yeah, they're not just patched up. They actually run – the installer runs from GOG.com, you know, with XP and Vista directly – and just plays beautifully. I downloaded Fallout 1. I did this on my XP machine. It took, like, granted I was using the fast Ziff server here, but I timed it. It was like 5 minutes from the time that I pressed the download now button on Fallout 1 till I had the load screen up. And it ran beautifully. And they also, when you buy it, you also then have access to PDFs of the manual. Then they had some other shit like the soundtrack, which was nice, the Fallout, some GIFs and
nice.
Wallpaper.
Did you listen to it?
I did listen to it.
You fucking liar.
I listened to it for 5 minutes. The fact there's actually cool shit on the Fallout soundtrack.
I actually, it's funny you say that because I fired up Fallout from GameTap like a week ago too because I've been on the road, so I'm trying to find crap I can play on my laptop, which mm-hmm. is not a hot gaming laptop.
Mm-hmm.
What a great game.
I mean, I
don't mean to sound like a No Mutants Allowed idiot, but... Oh, there goes the hate mail.
Oh, there you go. They're not idiots.
But I'd forgotten. I hadn't touched it since it released. And
yeah. Well, there's going to be a lot more of that as Fallout 3 gets
yeah,
closer.
Exactly.
That's a good idea. I had to turn in my loaner laptop back. It was just like a small ThinkPad, but that makes sense. Yeah, I can imagine if I bought a cheap laptop that's mainly just for word processing.
That's great. I mean, I'm not going to play it all the way through, but I played a couple hours of it, you know, killed some rats.
I think
like
this
that.
Thing was like $7 at Go
yeah,
Games,
how
something
can you
like
lose?
That.
How
so
can
you cannot lose. That was my pimpage of that site. But I do see
you
it.
Went overboard talking about the day, getting excited about the soundtrack, though, man. That's when I started to call bullshit.
I could sing the song.
Okay, go on.
Set the world on fire.
Keep on going.
I'm not going to keep going.
Quick, get the guitar.
Lose subscribers with every next note. So, yeah, no. It's a good soundtrack.
Okay. I believe it now. I want to
hear. How loud would you say you played it when you listened?
Loud? I cranked it, dude.
You cranked it?
Yeah.
Awesome.
What'd your family say?
I did this at work. I played at work.
No.
Yeah.
So we're just used to it?
Right. It was a good, it's, yeah, anyway, let's move on.
Okay, the other thing that was interesting is, well, from the moment that Blizzard showed Diablo 3 at BlizzCon in Paris, people on the internet community started, the internet community, like, what's that like?
Where are those fuckers? Let me kick them.
Yeah. Who is this internet community?
Yeah. Yeah. It's not a community either. It's just like a couple freaks, you know, like a couple freaks giving the rest of us online a bad name. Well, they immediately got to photoshopping the screenshots and show how Blizzard was ruining Diablo by having color in what should be a wretched, you know, world of devils and devilry, mm-hmm, demonic.
Right.
And
I believe the term that I saw on one of the doctored shots was "wow gayness." That's how it was being referred to.
Well, there was a rainbow
that Blizzard
in
has
one
brought
of
the
shots
"wow gayness" to Diablo
that,
3. Yeah, there was a rainbow
that Blizzard, while talking to MTV Multiplayer, said was there is kind of like just to push buttons. You know? So this is an interesting story. This is the second podcast in a week where I've mentioned, you know, Multiplayer. It's not that I don't want to pimp them, but this is a case where, like, when I read this, it's like, shit, why didn't we contact them on this? But what they did is they took the screenshots to Blizzard. Of course, Blizzard was already familiar with them. You can imagine,
of course,
at home hitting refresh on every, you know, on the Google page with Diablo 3 and it typed in, and they just, you know, I mean, they had some interesting things to say about. They're like, you know, in some cases the lighting that people did in Photoshop just wouldn't hold up in real time. It's just like it would be just too much of a burden on the game. In other cases, they said, well, if imagine, you know, in the screenshot you photoshopped, it's all skeletons or something. Imagine it's like a big menagerie of monsters or something, and you need to differentiate them because they have different weaknesses and they have different strengths, and you need to immediately recognize what you're up against. There's a reason for that. Things pop. Imagine also that you're not staring at a screenshot for 5 seconds, but you're playing this game for potentially hours on end.
Right.
Do you want to be staring at this murky
right
abyss?
Low contrast, yeah, near black and white mess. Right.
And
yeah,
it's like it doesn't. It's not like, oh yeah, Blizzard pwned them, but it's like they just like, they just came back. And
but they totally
they
did.
Justified.
But they did. Yeah.
They justified their decisions.
Right.
You know?
Of course.
I mean, I don't think it's in those terms. It's like they just said, hey, this is why we're doing it, and clearly you don't. We didn't spend all these years developing this game, and it just never occurred to us that maybe we could drop the saturation level a few fucking notches on our color.
But
you know.
The thing that kills me on this is not so much that anybody did this, but what's the launch date going to be on this game when my kids are in, you know, grandchildren? I mean,
yeah.
We're talking about a game that's.
You think it's going to be that long?
I don't think it's going to be spring.
They told me. They told Sean it's coming out next week.
But this is.
I did get word.
Next week.
Yeah. Sure to hear first on GFW Radio. Diablo 3 coming out August 14th.
They're going to announce it the day that two human ships. They're saying 1 week after that is when we're coming out.
Because they know it's going to compete.
Yeah, they're trying to crush two human.
No, but I mean, seriously. I mean, it's like
that's all lies. That's not
all
that's
lies.
Not the truth.
You know, that we saw the sort of one run through, which was a brilliant little marketing, you know, video, mm-hmm, that they did. Who's to say any of those assets are even going to end up in the final game?
This shit is ridiculous,
you know?
and it's embarrassing. And I got it. And props to today's Penny Arcade for roundly making fun of the folks who are doing this.
What
yeah,
was the guy's name? The Necromartyr?
Necromartyr. Yeah, pretty much says it all. I mean, to think that somebody's spending the time, you know, first of all, to get worked up about this. This is a game, this is like pre-alpha. They're not even begun, you know, to be done with this game. I mean, when I was looking at this, I was thinking, like, imagine, shit, I don't know, some movie director, Chris Nolan, Spielberg, whoever, whatever, put out some, like, early teaser trailer, and then you had fans, like, making their own, like, you know, screenshots of, like, how they think the movie should be because Chris Nolan is ruining it.
The equivalent I know of is in, like, Harry Potter books and stuff where there's this, like, sense of public ownership for
right
these things. But, I mean, other than that, can you think of other than, like, maybe Anne Rice and those, like, really popular, you know, fiction.
Well, Twilight, right? Right now.
Oh, God.
Like,
is your daughter
completely into Twilight. I had to buy the new book as soon as it came out, and she and her girlfriends who were all around
what's
the same
Twilight?
Age.
What's
See, you're not the demographic.
My 13-year-old niece was reading that.
There you go.
It's like a gothy,
it's teen
like
vampire.
Teen girl
it's teen,
thing.
Teen
except
vampires. Yeah.
Today, like the third time
Lost Boys?
I've seen an adult man reading one of those books.
I'm sorry.
And he was like a 25-year-old guy, and he was walking down the street reading one of them. You know,
my wife got totally hooked on them, and she keeps saying, "You gotta read this."
Yeah.
And I'm just
stay
like,
far away.
I like read the back of it, and I'm like. Really?
Yeah, well, I bought it. I went to buy it with my daughter, and we went to a Borders. And the guy behind the counter looked like he was maybe 26 or so. He was big, huge, looked like a comic book guy. And I was saying, so I hope it's good, just to my daughter. I wasn't talking to him, and he was like, "It is." I read it last night, and this was on the first morning. So the thing had come out at midnight. They had a midnight release. I read it in 2.5 hours.
Maybe it's brilliantly written.
Well, it might
be. Fact that it's
I don't
teen
know
vampires.
Anything about it. Right, it's just teen vampires. The point is, I brought it up because there's a movie coming out, and my daughter and her girlfriends are all refusing, or they're saying they are refusing to go see it because they believe that it's not faithful to the franchise. As they know it. And I've been giving her shit because it's like, well, you don't even know.
Well, it's just,
Lord of
the
Rings, doing
right?
the same thing with Batman.
What?
Yeah, you weren't. Maybe other people, though, were.
Certainly people have.
That would be indistinguishable from us in some people's eyes.
I mean,
true.
Do you guys actually really feel sorry for the proprietors of these, franchises? Like, they have fans who are so involved that they'll spend hours of their time, like, photoshopping what they want the game
figuring
to look
out
like.
That, like, the characters are lactating.
I mean, imagine if Blizzard imagine if Blizzard wasn't the
They're
one
freaks.
Making the games. Imagine if, Bethesda was making the game, right?
Right.
We know what kind of shit would hit the fan then.
Of course. I just find that it's so early on in the process to be making your own screenshots to show them how it should be done. It's like, why don't you just wait a little longer
and
see what they have up their sleeves?
And we're talking about palette and lighting. We're not talking about, well, they made it first person. I mean, it's like palette.
It wasn't even gameplay.
Right, it's not even gameplay. To say that the lighting is betraying the spirit of the franchise.
It's like picking out, like, colors for your wedding with your fiance or something, or like the
find something to get angry about with your life, for God's sakes.
And these are people who will sit around and play Diablo 3 for hours and get, like, audibly excited when they find a sword with, like, amazing special powers.
Diablo 3.
They're like, "Ooh, yeah!" No, I mean, when Diablo 3
comes out,
they'll be, like, so fucking excited about their little, like, man shopping trip into the Cave of Demons.
Because I'm sure nobody here has ever gotten excited about a loot drop.
Never.
Or WoW. Or
never. I've never audibly yelled.
I'm immune.
Well, Robert,
to
not
loot
so
drops.
Much. You haven't. You're probably.
I'm immune. Yeah. I could never play Diablo. In fact, like, seeing the screenshots of Diablo 3, the first time I've ever had any sort of, like, notion, like, oh, that could be interesting.
Diablo's skeleton clicked a game.
I had a roommate who played Diablo 2 for, like, a year. I mean, without taking a break. In college.
Literally a year.
He played it for a year. And, like, the only thing that he would ever do is, like, wipe his nose with Kleenex and throw him on the floor and order pizza. And I fucking hated that game. I would just, like, stare at it and try to figure out what he was doing.
Wait, did you hate the game or did you just hate that he was playing it all the time?
Don't hate the game.
I hated
hate
that
gamer.
He was playing it all the time, and I thought that the game looked like the most boring thing you could possibly do with a computer, including Microsoft Word.
Ouch.
So.
Shit.
Yeah, I was I've had this thing against Diablo from kind of similar experiences, like seeing, people playing and just, like, playing games of
just
the sort.
Proto WoW.
It's just like you just click fucking skeletons. But it's like, when I saw the demo for Diablo 3, I was like, okay, this actually looks pretty cool. There's like, because what I'm saying, it's, skeleton clicking the game, I'm like deliberately being reductive. And it's like, what I saw was like, okay, like, I'll stop being reductive. It looks I'll give it a try. Like, it looks cool.
I will try it out. I'm just saying. I'm sort of disturbed by the whole, like, psychology of, like, games that are about shopping for stuff.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, that's like 90% of what we do.
They've
yeah.
made everything is made that way. Soul Calibur is basically
right.
That game.
I mean,
right,
everything
now
is just kill stuff to get stuff to buy more stuff. Yeah, I mean, shopping and killing.
Some of the way that you unlock the items for the character creation in Soul Calibur, like, will clearly take forever. They'll take so long. I mean, it's like, what, get score 100,000 hits?
It's no different than unlocking your Uber saw in Team Fortress 2.
Yeah, that's ridiculous too, and that's been frustrating. And I know a lot of people that play Team Fortress are like, please devise some alternative means for people to acquire these weapons that don't want to go through and farm these achievements.
Please, you know? Give us microtransactions so I can give you a dollar to buy my sword.
And achievements is the thing that gets to me. The proliferation of the achievements is driving me crazy. And I'm speaking to somebody who was not anti-achievement in the beginning. With the 360.
I like achievements as long as they don't mean anything.
Okay.
Right? I mean, I'm more than happy to have something little go ding and a little thing go over my head and
Fine.
That strike the tuning fork in my loins because I feel good about something. I just don't want it to be what I have to do to keep playing the game.
You have a tuning fork down there?
Well, when you're using the achievement to get, like, I'm not saying Valve's doing this, but if you're saying their mentality was, we're going to put these achievements in here so people will play more in order to get these items, you know, it's like, you should be playing more because the game is good on its own. I mean, and it's ultimately empty. It's because, like, if you're playing just to get the achievements, then you get the achievements, and then what? They just keep adding more, and it's like...
Well, but you can say that about any game. Right. I mean, that's like, wow.
Or,
right?
But, or your life. You know, but there, and those
exactly.
People...
It's just like life. But God.
Those people, like, outnumber, like, Robert and I, like of our type. And I'm you people.
You people drive me crazy.
Get off my lawn.
Yeah, but no, I do think that there's, like, I mean, we're talking about different mentalities, and there's some of us that are, like, less, you know, just, like, drawn into that kind of thing. And it sucks, in a way, to see that that's just where it's going. I mean, that's what the people have spoken, and that's what we want. I mean, that's
I just don't play any game for more than a month, pretty much, period. Like, nothing for more than a month.
So you're just shallow.
I guess. I just want to play something else.
I get that.
The games that I'll play for years on end are strictly because I enjoy them so much. Like, you know, the Battlefield series games and Company Heroes and Soul Calibur, because, like, they're just fun. I don't need any extra incentive other than mastery, you know, and, like, and just good.
Other than mastery.
Kicking other than the crap out of everyone I see.
Absolutely the best.
I don't mean it that way.
Yeah.
So speaking of MMOs, are we done with the Blizzard and Diablo 3 nonsense?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
Pop, pop, pop.
So my final take is everybody just shut up and wait. If it sucks when it comes out, if it's all, like, purple and gay, then, you know.
Then don't buy it and don't play it and go away.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm sitting on my shirt, which has my glasses in them, so I can read the next item. Because it's a transition from Diablo and WoW stuff to Warhammer Online. Because Warhammer Online got an official release date as of today, which is September 18th. Finally coming out after 4 years. And one cancellation.
And half the stuff that it had a month ago.
Would you like to borrow my glasses?
There they are. They're in the ground. Great. Right. So it's coming out September 18th. They announced a pricing structure, $14.99 a month.
Fuck.
Yep. Or.
What, did you think it was going to be $8?
Yeah. Or if you pay for $41.97 for 3 months, that reduces you to $13.99 a month. Or you can pay $77.94 for 6 months, and then it's $12.99 a month.
Or you can give them a kidney and free for a couple of years.
And then they announce some other shit, like you can, you know, if you pre-order, you'll get in, so you can level up a few levels before before the masses get in there. That's
same stuff
that
Age of Conan did.
MMO stuff.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's about normal pricing.
Normal pricing.
Yeah,
it's normal, but it's for some reason it's always shocking to hear it because you think if like you're like really that's not that much. Like I'm sure you can convert it to pennies a day, but it's like when you add in all the other accounts, like Ryan's Suicide Girls account.
Robert. You've been sitting on that one for a while.
No, but for all the things that you pay subscriptions for, say if you got it, you know, Robert, you're telling me about thinking about getting an iPhone today. Then you've got another thing. You're just talking about how you just got cable now. So, well, you know, like Showtime and HBO.
Yeah,
that
it
the
costs
quality
hundreds
kind.
Of dollars a month more. To live.
And like seriously, if you get all these things, you know, they add up, and then at the end of the month, you put it all together, and you're like, fuck, ain't pennies a day anymore.
$15 is a lot a month. I am surprised that these things are not just Warhammer in general.
And
if you think an under $10 barrier.
If you're like a casual, and I don't mean casual in the sense that you don't play a lot, but like if you surf MMOs and like you play this one for a while, it's so easy to screw up. I had a month like 6 months ago where I realized that I was paying for 4 MMOs at the same time. And holy crap, I just spent $65 on games that I did not play all month long.
Yeah. Just like Suicide Girls, they need non-recurring accounts.
What we really need is a Suicide Girls MMO.
They need
then we'd be all set.
And we'd be rich.
They already have that. It's called Second Life.
Yeah.
That's the punchline for everything. They already do. It's called Second Life. Like, yeah. No matter Yoda. Dude, they should make a movie where Yoda does this. There you go. Fill it in. I had to go and cancel my Age of Conan account because I realized I just wasn't playing enough anymore.
Yeah,
you know?
Same.
And it's like, and then I was like, is this an impediment? Because now I'm never going to play it again because it would mean too much work.
Well, no, because they'll do a 2 weeks free thing, 6 months.
Yeah, they'll try
now.
To suck you back in.
And then they'll suck you back in.
Yeah. Like they're doing in WoW right now with this mount thing, right, Ryan?
That's pretty awesome, yeah.
Yeah. They're doing this refer a friend thing. If you get a friend to sign up for WoW and play for 60 days, is that right?
60 days.
60 days, then you get a new mount, which is exclusive to just this
Is
program.
It like a real mount? Like one that you'd actually
yeah.
want?
I imagine like
it's like a zebra.
Harvester schemes already going
oh,
on
totally.
In China.
Well, like there's also like people could
because
you
then
know,
you sell
I
those
could,
mounts
I could, right,
for more
also,
than the 14 for more than yeah. whatever the monthly fee is and for a new person to subscribe.
They're probably on eBay already.
Yeah. Yeah.
You could just start a second account.
Right. This is what people are talking about. Oh, I can make an email account and sign myself
right.
up.
And, so and they act like they're cheating Blizzard, too, I bet.
Yeah, right. right.
Sorry ass fuckers.
Right. It's only going to cost me. Oh, wait.
I don't think I've ever played a game with a subscription fee before.
Yeah, it's kind of sobering when you do. I did mine in the past couple years. It's the first time I did it. Actually, it was this year. What was the first time? Lord of the Rings, maybe?
Yeah.
When I first
You're
played
not
that.
The Lord of the Rings.
And I, yeah. Well,
hey, that's trademarked.
Secret identity.
Yeah, it's kind of like, it's kind of scary. And then you, like, you got to remember, like, that's what happened with Conan. I was like, oh, shit. Like, I always sweat, and I'm like, I got that Conan bill that's going to come up if I don't
right.
cancel this.
I got to go
and
play. I got to go play.
So it made me yeah. think about it in yeah. the negative terms. Conan became associated with, like, they're going to try to fucking
with, like,
charge
your,
me.
Right. Utility bill.
Yeah.
The water bill. Yeah. Here's a fucking Conan.
That's
bill.
Why I like the psychology.
Got electricity right. bill.
I wanna
phone
go.
Bill. Conan right. bill.
I want to go to a town hall meeting this political season for like Obama or McCain and be like, "What are you doing about the rising Conan bills of all the citizens of Conan Land yeah. or whatever the fuck they call it?"
Petition for like universal Conan.
Yeah, yeah.
Universal Conan.
My WoW bills are through the roof.
In Sweden, they're playing. For free,
we need WoW relief.
Universal
right?
yeah. Conan for all.
WoW relief.
It'll get to that point one of these days.
That's sad.
WoW keeps on trucking.
Yeah. So we'll see about Warhammer. But yeah, I mean that's of course the big problem with all of these is convincing people to pay yet another right. bill. Like first of all, to get the WoW players to give that up, and try this one out.
Well, when is Lich King coming out? It's in beta now.
It's in beta now, and right.
It's probably coming out soon.
As soon as they can to squash everybody else, right? I mean, that's what's got to happen.
Yeah, you can speculate on how they'll time it or not with Warhammer. Because certainly Warhammer, you know, I guess I still can't talk about it because of the NDA. But it is the big one. It's from EA, you know, who have a lot of money behind them. And from Mythic, who made Dark Age of Camelot. EA's last MMO?
Yeah.
Well, Ultima Online,
of course, is still there, but then they've got a pile of failures besides that.
Majestic.
Not to mince words. And Majestic, Earth
City.
And Beyond, Motor City Online, Sims Online. You know, you know, insert the wah-wah sound after each one of those. So,
Price is Right loss.
Yeah, Price is Right loss.
Hellgate.
Bum, 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 bum.
Yeah. Right.
Hellgate in a
and
way.
Hellgate.
Yeah.
So, you know, they need a hit this time. But they've got Mythic is doing it, and they made Dark Age of Camelot, which still holds up as one of the great MMOs.
And I think gamers will give them a lot of slack. I mean, their sort of core MMO audience, I think they'll get the normal blip where, you know, everybody who's
sure.
hardcore, they'll sell a million copies or
yep.
700,000 copies in the first month. And then, like I think we've seen with Age of Conan, it's a question of whether they can hang on to it 60, 90 days later.
Right. That's the problem is that everybody goes over for the novelty factor. Then everybody who's there is going to spend a month dissing WoW and saying how this is the great thing.
And then go back to WoW.
And then half the people like Sean will quit outright and the rest will go back to WoW.
But that's just how I am. Like I enjoy – it's not because – you know, it's like it's not like I'm looking for WoW or something because WoW has never held me. But it's
right.
like I just – like it's satisfying enough to me to play an MMO for 30 days.
Right. Well, I mean, how many games do we all really play for more than 30 or 40 hours?
I think that's the key.
You know,
and, right.
You know, there are a few, like, you know, some multiplayer games.
Yeah.
But you know, they're not. It's got to be a pretty exceptional game to have you suck it up month after month after month.
Right, which is what WoW achieved, and certainly not just WoW. I mean, EverQuest, and really, I mean, to be fair, all these MMOs have a certain amount of fans that do feel that it's enough to continue on for years, right?
Since WoW seems so hard to beat, MMO makers should go out of their way to create, like, a new kind of thing, which would be, like, the WoW vacation. Like, you make a game that's explicitly, like, from the ground up created to be the thing that you're going to take a break from WoW to play for a couple of months.
That's a great idea.
Like, we're going to shut it grinding for 9 months. After 2 months.
Right. Right. Little 3 month package.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
That's right. Getaway.
Every year from, like,
Getaway from Asgard.
That's a fucking great idea.
That's a great idea there.
Yeah.
It's called, like, your dog, your daughter, your wife, all those moving, noisy things in your household that, like, continually distract you.
You've spent 9 months grinding in Outland. Now it's time to get away.
Well, we'll see.
Come grind in. Yeah, whatever. Whoops. Did I just yank
just
my cord?
Broke the system, man. No, okay.
Broke mine. But we'll see what they say next
week. Yeah, I'm like fading in.
I did something. I banged it.
Yeah.
Oh.
La-di-de-la.
Check the plug. You did bang it. Man.
I did. I hit it with my foot.
All right,
I've only got sound in my left ear, and I'm pretty sure that that's not me.
We're going down.
Damn it.
Party foul. That's it.
Whatever Party foul.
Doing is,
yeah.
Whatever you're just
yeah, like, that's it.
Are we good?
We're good.
All right.
I still hear it kind of cutting in.
Yeah, all over the place.
But you're hearing it there?
It's all.
Okay.
Cool.
Anyway, they have a big presence at Gen Con next week, and I'm sure.
The Warhammer folks. Sure, of course. Right.
So, and Dragon Age, big, much
Dragon
bigger
Age,
presence
huge,
than anybody thought was going to be there. So, we'll see what they say.
Fill us in.
Are you going to Gen Con?
Yeah.
Awesome. Great.
Go straight from here to Indianapolis for 5 days of gaming goodness.
That's a good time.
What's Gen Con for the non.
It's E3 for people who don't like electricity, pretty much. It's pen
never
and paper.
Gotten around
it's,
the whole electricity thing.
Yeah, exactly. You know, they're
it's
Luddite,
the devil's lightning.
Luddite gamers for
but
years.
But the electricity's
no,
creeping in, though.
It totally
obviously.
Is. Totally is. I mean, well, last
why,
year.
Why is gaming taking over all these conventions, like Comic Con and
gaming?
Stuff too?
Well,
Gen Con is
a gaming.
Well, video gaming.
So. I think it's reality. I mean. You know, role-playing gamers came out of Dungeons & Dragons and then discovered electricity and started playing WoW. So, of course, Blizzard's going to be there.
Yeah.
And, you know.
It's so just because E3, like, they shut E3 down and it was, like, shutting down the bar and everyone's, like, wandering out and trying to find another place
They're
to get
pubbing.
A drink.
Yeah. Everybody's pubbing. Yeah.
They also show well in those kind of environments, like Comic-Con and stuff, too. You know, it's like you can have someone sitting up there in a panel. Frank Miller talking, or you can just have like,
well, I think the you know Gen Con has clip, become you know? Kind of the place to go see RPGs.
That's
for a completely reasonable reason. I mean, the best pre-launch stuff for The Witcher was all at Gen Con, right? Because it's the target audience. You know,
of
you
course,
get 50,000 geeks in a room.
It sounds fun. I want to go.
So you should.
I wanted to go.
Mostly, I lock myself in a couple suites and play board games. That's
that doesn't sound fun.
that sounds great to me. I would do that.
Yeah. Why don't you go, Jeff?
I can't.
Really?
Maybe I could.
Well, he was just saying this big Dragon Age reveals.
Yeah.
I know.
There
I
should be some.
I've
scheduled
PC coverage. That's
maybe I should.
I've got stuff scheduled.
But I'll just be in
something
Julian's
brilliant
room playing board games.
Send it on to you guys.
What board games are you going to play, Julian?
I don't know. Whatever's there. Whatever's new. Whatever's hot.
Oh, you're
that's
not,
the whole routine there is you go on the floor and you see all the stuff that everybody's been making all year long. And then you buy it. And then you take it back to your room and you play it with friends.
And then you never play it again.
No, not true.
So what's the party atmosphere like?
You got totally got to make it yourself.
Robert's getting ready to mock.
What kind of hard drugs do people do when they lock themselves in a hotel room to play board games that have been recently released?
There are distinct subcultures. There are a very large contingent of people you don't particularly want to hang around.
You got your White Wolf people.
You got your LARPers running around through the walls. You know, generally endocrine challenged in some way. but then there's, you know, there's a whole raft of cool people too. I mean, you put 50,000 geeks in a room.
Yeah,
you know, they're going to be 1,000 you don't mind hanging out with.
I think we'd all feel at home there. Even you, Robert.
I have a crew of about 60 or 70 people that we've been going every year forever. And they're all remarkably normal. A lot of them are game designers.
That's a lot of
them come from the video game industry or their press. And so we just rent the whole floor in a hotel.
Jeez, I've got like 5 friends.
Drink like crazy.
I know, I was going
to
say.
How do you know 60
well, come
people?
To, come to Indianapolis, man. Come to Indianapolis.
That's a friendly town, man.
It is. Yeah. Totally friendly.
Is that must be like a biker convention coming in. like 50,000.
It is. It's very strange. And you can tell people are just shell-shocked.
Are they all dressed up and shit?
Because it's way worse than E3 ever was. Because E3, first of all, you're not in a little town like Indianapolis.
Right.
Yeah. And second of all, it's predominantly professional people and then some smelly teenagers. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's always really what it was. And Gen Con is just freak city, self-included. Yeah. Me too.
Right.
You know?
You're not pointing fingers.
Yeah, I'm not. It's just, it's all, it's deep, deep subculture stuff.
It's like, it's like a swarm of locusts that comes in, and within like 30 minutes, all of the Red Bulls, all of the Red Bulls and pizzas are gone. They can't like find a hamburger in the whole town.
But it's also different because everybody's there to play games. Yeah. Right? I mean, there are panels and stuff like that, but for the most part, people come to play games.
It's cool that it's like you actually play the game. It's not just all like promotional, like E3.
No, there's actually very little. There are no big press conferences and stuff like that. Yeah. There's a lot of backroom stuff. So, like, everything that I have scheduled video game wise isn't happening on the floor. Mm-hmm. It's happening in some suite where they've got two demo machines set up, which is a much better way to do that.
Right.
Stuff
this
anyway.
Is traditionally why we don't cover it. In fact, I'd sent out an email to the 1UP edit saying, like, hey, should we cover Gen Con this year? And the immediate response from Shane was a photo that he had gotten from Google of a crowd of Gen Conners. It was like,
so
you sure you want to go?
Well, I got you back.
I think it would be fun to go there and cover, but it's just not really like –
There will be maybe one or two things. The funny thing is all the knockoffs going the other way. So, like, there's a Star Wars Galaxies card game being launched at Gen Con. It's like, woohoo!
That's
big press release on that one.
Yeah,
you know, and there's an EverQuest card game that has an expansion coming out, and so it's all sort of going the other direction. Video game companies pushing down into the
trade.
I would just like to go walking around, being like, "Hey, you want to play checkers? you like checkers?
I did some great.
We're trying to sell some game. Like, we can go and we can make a game. Yeah, and we'll like make up the most bullshit, hand draw all these like insane rules, and try to get people to play it with us. And as we sit down and play with them, it'll be revealed like it's just increasingly insane.
But
and see if
make up the rules
like,
as you go.
No, and then we can start accusing them of cheating us and
you
stuff.
Couldn't possibly be weirder than the real world. I bought a game there that was totally not a joke.
Yeah.
Swear to God, 5 years ago called Ebola Monkey Hunt.
Wow. That sounds like someone like trying to like let's make something wacky.
Yeah, but they were totally serious, and it got
they were
progressively
like
crazier.
About it, like
it was like
seen
you were trying to
or something.
You were trying to like carry these monkeys around and infect your friends with Ebola, and then run away before you died. It was just the most lame, crazy ass stuff. And every year, there's like six or seven of these guys that you walk by their booth, and you're like, oh, dude, I really hope you didn't
see that would
like,
be fun. Like you should go like for us and like just try to assemble like the nuttiest games that you can find.
We should bring a video.
I'll do my best. I do audio every year. I'll send you guys.
Great. I mean, why doesn't 1UP just cover board games? I mean, what's the difference?
Besides a market.
Well, we've
it's tiny. A big, huge print run, like the World of Warcraft adventure game that kicks 100,000 units over the course of its life. It was like big time success.
Oh, wow. We've talked about this. I mean, it's not out of the realm of possibility that
it's
at
just
some
small.
Point.
I mean, how come
it's
you're not
hard
doing?
Enough
how come you're not doing giant
it's hard
page
enough on the stories
on
like this
games
week?
It's 100,000 units.
Like this week, we put up Laura Krieger's virtual jihadi story. It's fantastic. Today, Robert's story on pro gaming levels up just went up. It's like hard enough to get people to pay attention to this. It's like
to feature,
right?
Not
and as our critics
like
would say, it's
going
you know
to be paying
we don't
attention
adequately
to
cover what we should be covering already. Yeah. So to expand,
much as I love it and would love to write it, it wouldn't make much sense.
Right?
So. Have any of you been to PAX? I'm going for the first time this year, and Anthony Gallegos is warning me that it's
your fans are gonna love
freak,
you there,
Freak City. My
I'd
fans.
Like to go. You got fans,
and that's coming to pretty much New York. Everybody guesses next year.
Really?
Is that right?
Yeah.
PAX
East.
Like two.
PAX East. I'll actually go. To
that thing is getting big. I think you're right again. It's the E3
fallout.
It's
the new E3.
Just like GDC.
It should be fun, and it's Seattle. I love that place.
So to get back on Warhammer, I actually think you should try it, Sean. I would like your
opinion
of it
because
most of these other MMOs, this realm versus realm stuff they have going, I think might appeal to the.
I'm
going to
be the expert on levels 1 through 30 in all MMOs ever made,
along with everybody else.
Well, this only goes to 40, so and 30 to 40 is where it gets really interesting in Warhammer. Seriously,
have you been playing? Are you in the beta? So you can't
I'm in the beta, but I can't talk about any of the beta stuff, but.
But you just said it was interesting.
Oh, you're fired.
You said it was interesting.
Is that breaking the NDA?
Damn.
I meant it's not interesting.
Right.
Oh, no, wait. I can't say that either.
Jeff Green says Warhammer is not interesting.
Neither interesting nor not interesting is my take on Warhammer. It merely is.
When can you talk about it? I know some, like, I think it's IGN.
I don't know. I mean, now that it's coming out, what did I say? September 18th? They got to quit that damn NDA thing. So we could pimp it or not.
We should be getting hands-on with Red Alert 3 soon, too. Hopefully we're not embargoed so we can play and talk about it right away.
Right. I want to get to that. The other date announcement today was GTA 4 coming to the PC on November 18th.
Very cool.
We all happy about that?
I am with the history. You know, remember when I was on talking about San Andreas Online? If they're able to work this out. Well, of course, it's already got online support, so... and just like mod it. It's never a bad thing for GTA to be on PC because traditionally, like, the scope of mods that come out.
Julian, did you play GTA 4?
I played not all of it. I probably put in 15 hours or something like that on the 360, but I'm just not it bugs me. I need to play a good guy. It's really what it comes down to.
Really?
I'm shallow that way.
Does it start bothering you, like, morally as you're playing the game?
It just makes me uncomfortable. I just don't enjoy it very much. I don't like being a punk in the sense that GTA sort of makes you feel like a punk. I admired the game. There's a ton about it. But all the time I was playing it, I kept thinking, God, I wish these people had made a game I wanted to play. You know, because you know, the levels, I mean, they're not really levels. The world design, the art, you know, some of the stuff they did with the engine was really off the charts. But just wish they'd made a game I wanted to play out of it.
They're bringing this port around pretty fast for them, I'd say. It's pretty cool it's coming this fast.
Yeah. Any of us finish it?
I finished it.
You did?
Yeah.
Yeah? Was it worth finishing?
I mean, I felt compelled to finish it. It was sort of like strangely in one ear and out the other for me. Like, the biggest probably game that I've played all the way through this year, and when I think back about it, just there's not much that stuck with me other than the fact that, like, I really enjoyed the beginning section, you know, when you're sort of off the boat immigrant, and it was this new kind of character for them,
and
they really try to make you think you were kind of like a decent guy and give you a plausible reason for why you're a violent prick, you know, because you were like a soldier in the Balkan Wars or something. I don't know. But then it just steadily transforms into like a totally cliched remake of every Grand Theft Auto game ever. Like, you eventually end up working for the mob and you do all the same bullshit you've always done, and you murder about 10,000 people, and after about 15 hours you just start running people over the street because you no longer give a fuck about
and you realize it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. Even, you know, you get, you know, it was cool. I mean, I enjoyed it, but it wasn't the be all.
What did the GameTap review say of it?
But what they compared it to, like, John Steinbeck and Mark Twain, right?
Oh yeah,
was it that one? That review. Yeah.
It was definitely like Huckleberry, the Adventure Berries, the Adventure Berries of Huckleberry Bick or something.
The Adventure Berries. Saturday morning cartoon.
Adventure Berries. Yeah. Yeah, I do wonder at the end of the year what's gonna, you know, what the gaming press is gonna be saying about GTA 4 and MGS 4 after the, you know, endless splooge fest.
Well, but
leaving like ourselves out of that.
Like BioShock, I mean, these things are just giant things that you chew on and you get through the end of them.
Right.
Sometimes they're like Chinese food. It's like, that was awesome. And then,
well, we spent, you know, but the whole press spent, you know, a couple weeks there with each of those games. Like, it's a new pinnacle in the art form. And now here we are in August, and I'm not hearing anybody talk about either game at this point already. I mean, are they done?
I mean, I'm not saying much because I don't want to rehash the discussions.
Yeah, I know. We've talked about this a lot.
But I mean, I was curious if, like, that Robert did finish it, because I know all of us, for different reasons we've talked about, kind of hit the wall.
But that's the other thing, is people played it, and they either finished it or they returned it,
right,
and we moved on. It's not like an MMO that's going to live forever.
Well,
I did find it
perpetually enjoying. I didn't hit any sort of wall. I didn't have the same problem that I had with other GTA games where you hit this, like, difficulty thing where you've got some insane mission where you have to fight the controls all the time to, you know, luck out and beat some horde of cops or something. It was all approachable and pretty fun.
I liked everything I played, and the only reason I stopped, I guess I mentioned this before, it's just because I'd hit a mission that was just too, to, you know, adult only audience for me to play at in front of my wife or kids. So, yeah. You know,
what was all. It?
It was the having to kill everybody at the strip club.
Oh, okay.
So yeah. It was combining two things, you know, strip club and murdering everybody. Like, okay.
Yeah, that could be kind of awkward in front of the kids.
Everything else, though, no problem. He had the 3-year-old niece there, you know.
Yeah.
I do, but I it is in my head to go back to it because I was enjoying what I played. So I didn't mean to diss GTA 4. I just find that it's interesting that the discussion completely dried up. But maybe that's just what happens.
Right? It's funny for me, like, that game is so uneven, and the brilliant parts of it make you expect more out of it. You know, like, the writing could be, like, really impressive or just totally fucking lame, you know, bro frat boy jokes, you know?
Yeah.
I'm going to eat one of your cookies.
Okay.
Speaking of eating,
yeah.
Ah.
we've been getting candy continually.
Oh yeah.
Thank our listeners who send us candy from around the world. I got Jeff, by the way, again, a follow up on the Taiwanese batch. I got Jeff and then the rest of the floor today to finish the bag of, like, I don't know, they were like these gooey plums in a sack. And then we got pictures of you up on our community manager Tina's blog eating one. I don't think they were as bad as your face made it look.
Shit was bad.
Wait, I had
I wasn't
one of those,
making
right?
a face
yeah,
for
you
the
had
photo
one today, Robert. Yeah.
The thing is, he goes, "Here's a candy," and I bite into it. There's a fucking pit inside of it, like a hard pit. It's a piece of fruit. It's dried.
Yeah,
fruit.
It was like well, when it mushed
when that,
and it
when
smelled.
When that sticky, smelly thing was in your hand, you were like, this isn't a Starburst." Like you're just like.
I mean, it kind of had the shape of like a jelly, you know.
Yeah,
fruit
see, it grossed
thing.
Me out just the look of it and the feel of it.
I can't like get past.
I think it tasted fine.
Capybara testicle.
And then what was the stuff you? That, then what was this Negro candy you brought me?
Negro comes from.
Let me say to clarify. That's what
Jeff,
it was called.
You said you'd never talk like that on the podcast.
I'm not using the word like. It's not descriptive. That was actually the brand name. Perhaps it's Negro. I don't know.
A Slovenian listener sent us a whole box of candy, and in the box there were 3 or 4 bags of Negro brand Negro candy.
Right.
And we have those. And
I didn't mean like
it's got to be like
colored
I don't know.
Candy.
I don't know the first thing about pronouncing the language. So, but he here's the letter worth reading from him. He says. Hello, and who can do a good Slovenian accent?
Nobody. We don't know what that is.
We don't need to do it. Okay, but he says, hello and welcome, GF Radio crew, to your box of candy. please take this box of candy and its inhabitant as a gift for your successful transition and great coverage
of
E3.
Was there a snake in there?
No, but I'm thinking the inhabitant might be there was a Pez dispenser in the shape of a character from Pirates of the Caribbean. And I want to thank him, but unfortunately, I don't know the first thing about pronouncing and the various accent marks used in this, but butchering your name, I'm sorry, it's like M-A – actually, I just won't butcher it. There's a nickname. It's Thaney, but it's M-A-T-E-V-Z, and then, you know, with an accent mark on
although
the
although it's such an exotic accent that we can't even say what it is.
I don't even want to try because I honestly know it's going to be nothing like it. It's like, you know, when you read, like – like who was the, what was Pope John Paul's name before he – became the Pope.
Don't look at me. I'm the Jew in the room. Why are you looking at me?
Sparky McGee.
I'm not up on my popes.
Just like the Polish name stuff. There's like, I try and then like I hear it on the BBC or something. I'm like, well, good thing I bothered. You know I just don't bother anymore. I need to learn. But so thanks so much for the candy. And there was a lot of good stuff in there. The Negroes were good. That's I'm not joking. They were good. They were eucalyptus, and like there's another one that was like licorice.
Is there something inside of it? Because I saw those. They kind of look like cough drops or something. Was
yeah,
it hard
they
candy
have
or?
Some stuff inside.
Yeah. I like the really licorice-y, chewy thing.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on. Yesterday, Tina, our community manager, walked in. I was behind closed doors in my office because I was trying to write something, and she knocks on the door. I open it up, and she says, don't be mad at me. Sean Elliott told me to do this. And she takes one of those Negro candy wrappers and tapes it to my monitor. So it's taped, you know, facing me. It just says Negro. And I left it up there for about 10 minutes.
The box also came with 2 packs of Slovenian non-filter cigarettes. So Anthony got this guitar. He plays, like, classical guitar or something. He had it in here with the capo on. And I told I flung open your door, and I had him walk in playing this, like, song. And then I came in with the pack of cigarettes with a single one extended and offered it to you, and I was like singing in a
yeah, it was this oddly was weird, like accent. Kind of spaghetti western moment where these yeah. two walk in serenading me with him holding a cigarette. It's like, it's like some kind of like punked candid camera moment. What the fuck's going on here?
So who's gonna smoke the cigarettes?
I'll try one. The Jeff will have one. Well, before we went in, Anthony yeah. was like, look, Jeff has his door closed. He doesn't look happy. And I'm like this ain't going to fucking make him happy.
It did.
I know.
I was writing something for EGM, so I wasn't happy. Yeah. Not that I don't like them. I do. I love them. Fine magazine. Available now. Go buy it. So do we need to – I don't need to apologize for this Negro thing, do I?
No, it's just funny in case. It's not like we
just in case. Let me just say that that was the name of the candy.
Yeah,
right.
Okay. Here I've got Al Sharpton on my quick dial.
Well, in Spanish, it just means black. It just means black, and
right.
some of the
we
candies.
Know this.
I think the original candy probably was licorice, and it was black.
Right,
and then they branched out with other kinds, and that's when some of them are like green. And that's what's funny. It's like when you got a bag of obviously green candies, and it's called like Negro or whatever it's called.
Yeah,
and it's also from Slovenia. It's not. We're not talking about like the shit's from Madrid or something, you know?
Right. Yeah. Well,
so it was just weird. It was like
yeah. When you told me to come in and look at the stuff, and I saw from far away the name, I thought for sure that was going to be like some Sambo character on the thing. I thought it was going to be actually
but there's not.
But it had nothing to do with it.
It has yeah. a chimney sweeper on it. It's weird. There's this like photograph of a chimney sweeper.
Yeah, which is a weird thing to put on your candy.
Yeah, and that, you know.
Tastes like ash.
There's something. There is something weird about it. I don't know.
No, you seized your
and yet
throat
you
after
ate this.
Been breathing in.
I didn't have any of those. I had some sort of licorice, chewy thing, and I had something that called itself toffee, but tasted like Starburst, but like some sort of crazy flavor that tastes
like if
every
the Rico
Starburst
the Rico
flavor
man,
possible.
Like, blew his horn into a Starburst. So it had all kinds of like herbal like accents.
Yeah, yeah,
and stuff
yeah.
To it.
This is pretty weird. But I had like six of them.
The other thing, the Taiwanese candy, there was a bag of like I think it was like dried salted shredded plum, but they looked. I was telling everyone that it was like desiccated sea slug, and or it's not even slug, snails. Like just a little, because they're small enough, you know, that they're pulled off at low tide, and like no one would try that.
Really?
I took
surprised.
I was like, oh, I took like a dip of it, like it was, you know, like Big League Chew or something.
Oh, God. There was a guy on our boards who said he was going to send us some English sweets.
We've got some before, and I always welcome them.
What are they? What are English sweets?
Sweets is
I don't know, but
what,
they must
what,
do something horrible to your teeth.
What British people call
it. No, see, that,
hey
that's
now.
Offensive.
Yeah, that's offensive.
It's what our friends over there call candy. Sweets. But they're the makers of, right now, my number one. I'm trying to, like, rank the world. I'm like, you got to send me the – prove that your country's got the best candy throughout
what
the world.
What a racket he's got going on.
Yeah, no shit.
Right now – right
especially
now.
If you're listening in Switzerland.
Right now, though, the Roundtree's fruit gum is like my favorite. That's the best shit. Yeah,
I think you need some more chocolate. I'm disappointed by how
I'm not
little
so much
chocolate.
Into the chocolate stuff.
I am. So my address.
I am too.
Well, there's chocolate in the batch from Slovenia. Why don't
really?
You guys help
I
yourself?
I've been chocolate.
Every time. It's not. And also for the listeners who sent it, I don't just sit there and hoard this stuff. I encourage everyone on the floor to come in and.
He does.
And grab it.
Yeah, and he makes sure he watches us like as we look through his candy and tells us what we can and can't eat.
Yeah, you only bring the gross stuff over.
No, I do.
Here, have these desiccated
you,
sea
the
tr- slugs.
The rule is you come into the office to get the good stuff, and uh-huh. if you don't come, then I come to you.
Right. It's like, but when you come by, it's sort of like the guy who's like, oh, God, smell this. You know? Like, why would I? Yeah, you're like, Jeff, eat this.
Well,
like,
there's like
hell
was,
no.
What was the Puerto Rican shit called? I forgot that, like, you – what we found out that you're supposed to spit it out into someone's hair, and as you spit, you it's like a plosive, the word for what this thing is, and you say that.
Huh.
Remember, it was like a little paper. It was a construction paper tube filled with just like cornmeal and like a little bit of sugar to sweeten it, and that is supposed to be candy in Puerto Rico. But it's like I forgot the name. Someone wrote in and another Puerto Rican listener to explain what it's called, and he said that yeah, like you. Kids take this, you fill your mouth with it, and then you go behind someone and you spit it all over in their hair, and it dries like cement. And as you spit out, you say, "Then go Fio." You go like
that sounds like total fucking bullshit.
Yeah, yeah. Guess what? We got the GFW guys. To
yeah,
do
that sounds yeah. like total bullshit.
Multiple people then confirmed it. Why don't you
really?
Multiple
so
accounts,
in other words, it's
maybe.
Griefer candy.
Yeah.
Green for Kane.
That sounds pretty fucking ridiculous. I ate half of that package, and I made sure other people ate the rest.
You're a brave
of it.
Man with this fern candy. I got
now
say.
That we're pimping, now that we're trying to get free candy and stuff, I've been meaning to pimp. Like, this sounds like the saddest thing, that I'd have a Twitter account, and it's even like I should be embarrassed I'm pimping it. But my thing and my rule is, like, it's not like, guys, here's what I'm having for lunch, or like, guys, here's, like, you know, I don't know, I woke up, my neck was sore, or whatever kind of shit. It's like, it's just a link dump for all the kind of things that I normally send people on.
Yeah, but it's all like buried
day.
In tiny URLs, so it's completely blind.
It's a surprise.
You have no idea what you're
going to
get.
It's like a URL grab bag, yeah. And so, like, yeah. I encourage people to go. It's just like my
but,
name.
But he can't
Sean
be
Elliot.
Held responsible for if you lose your job.
Just assume it's
right.
not safe
no,
for work
I will mark,
or family.
I will mark things not safe for work. But, like, the deal, we all work at different places, so it's like, I don't understand.
I work in a basement, so yeah. It's pretty much all okay.
So, no, for the most part, I'll try to mark anything that's obviously offensive, but it's like, I'm now spreading my aim links with the world, so, yeah.
Nice.
Trying to get you on.
Ziff Davis is not held responsible.
Yeah, it's not
Twitter
work
links.
Related stuff. Well, yeah. Then, like, there's one, like, I'll put, like, do not click. Like, if the prefix is do not click.
Really don't.
Don't
just fucking don't.
Click, you know? Yeah.
Like, then why'd you post it?
Because there's someone that's going to be curious. And it's like the one with the guy, the partially sex change transsexual with the bottle of whiskey up his ass, and he's like flipping. He looks like D. Snyder, and he's like holding out a banner that says internet between two middle fingers.
God, okay.
But that's as bad as it's ever gotten. For the most part, it's just funny or interesting.
Hitting the end of the podcast.
So you were sharing that
straight
with us as a way
wall.
Of showing us that it never goes that crazy.
But that's the
worst thing I've ever put up. I mean,
but that was do not click, though.
But here's the thing about your link, Sean. You see, yesterday I'm sitting in my office, and he sends me one of these, and it's an Obama in a Superman shirt thing, right? Or ripping open his shirt to show a Superman logo.
And he's wearing an O.
Right, okay. So he sends me that, and I look at it, and I'm just like, ha-ha. And then he's like, well, what does that remind you of? So I click on the link, and it's Obama in a T-shirt. So I'm like, okay, phew. This wasn't offensive or gross or disgusting, and this isn't going to make me want to gag like half the other link Sean
sent. No, dude, come on. They're not like that.
Okay,
don't
a third of the link.
No.
But then he says, okay, so what does this remind you of? And I'm just like, I don't know, Superman 2? I don't know. And then should I say what it was?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, you know, he's, like, holding his shirt, like, open, you know.
No, but there's an O. He's got a giant O insignia, and he's,
right,
like, ripping his shirt.
Yeah, right. So, right? Oh, so yeah, like, you guys know.
It was Goatsy.
Oh, it's Goatsy.
Was it,
right?
a real, was it a real thing? Like
it was
a real
Alex Ross. He paints for he did Kingdom Come for DC.
Unintentional Goatsy.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it's ridiculous. I can't believe Alex Ross painted this, and it's, like, 100% like a Goatsy tribute. Like, it's like Alex Ross.
But, see,
like,
I never would have thought that in a million years, dude. Until you said that, and then I couldn't unsee it, and then I was grossed out.
Someone should make a Goatsy T-shirt where it's not the explicit thing, but just two hands in a circle, so that like only people who know what it is could ever walk by and be disgusted, and then you would know.
Yeah,
like you're walking down the street and you see someone make a face, and you're like, ha! I know that you have seen Goatsy.
Two hands like fighting over a giant Cheerio.
There's like a whole wiki page on this that has like all of these obscure Goatsy.
Yeah, found
references.
It's like found Goatsy. Yeah, it's like just naturally occurring Goatsy.
God. I can't even, yeah.
But that wasn't even, like, that was just super tame. Like, that was just, like, a throwaway link, but it was just, like, funny.
I know, but you wrecked my day anyway.
I don't know why, man. You're
it's not as bad as the link you were sending around, like, last year about the girl, like, accidentally losing her bowels in a hot tub. That was
okay.
Messed up.
See, that was just funny.
No, that was
not
sick.
Funny.
That I laughed at.
That was funny, man.
That was funny.
Because it was all like a model chick in a bikini.
It was,
yeah. In a hot tub.
Like, yeah.
That's like funny. Like, see, if it was just like a sick old person, it wouldn't be funny. It'd be sad, right?
Yeah.
But it was funny because it was like, you know, she would recover from it. You know, it's like she's used to getting all this attention all the time and. It's like she finally got a taste of what it's like to be the rest of us. We just shart when we can't help it.
Yeah. Not all of us have done that, Sean. I mean, don't lump me into that.
You were the one who was all excited about the
about the, what do they call the hot tub party? What did they call that though?
Hold on now.
The hot tub party.
I was not the bowl with the key.
I was not quote unquote excited about this.
In Berkeley, you were way excited about the hot tub release party.
I beg your pardon.
Clarification, please.
On Craigslist, there was a party in Berkeley, and it was listed as a hot tub release party. And
what
so
were they releasing?
You clicked it.
Yeah, what do you think? Yeah.
So we clicked it. We're like, dude, like free CDs. Jeff already explained how he's attracted to like cheap music. So you're like, you know, like I'm going to get in this thing. But then you read the whole description. It was basically, yeah, like everyone simultaneously evacuates their bowels.
Yeah. This wasn't a release party like the new Harry Potter coming out.
Here, I thought we were getting back to video games.
Exactly.
But what was I thinking?
You had to take it to the...
Was it for real?
I don't know.
How do you know?
It was probably a Sean Alt account for all of
them. Well, the classic one about the old guy I posted, that's the wiki thing about the old guy who's taking a picture of himself and he's got a picture of a model train and he's like telling people to come over and like stomp on the train like they're Godzilla.
And get the free crab meat.
And like have a Joe. And then like, he's like, when you leave, I got a bunch of imitation crab meat in the freezer. He's like, it's not bad. We just got too much of it. Like, you take that with you. That
he spells it K-R-A-B.
Yeah, that was from...
That was you.
That was
right?
No, it wasn't for me, but it was from a Something Awful account that a person who's like has like a special genius for making up fake Craigslist ads.
Did you see that there was a...
It was kind of genius because it was so sad that it seemed real.
Yeah, and it was like,
it
well,
was
he,
just
there's like
pathetic.
All this like specificity that starts off, it's like you age 22 to 70. Like, but it's like, oh yeah, no, the specificity was like, do not contact me for like solicitations and
right,
stuff.
Right, yeah.
And like
yeah,
had all these
very
rules,
real looking.
Yeah. Did you see that last Sunday, the New York Times Magazine had a feature on trolling? They talked to all these guys from like 4chan and stuff and sort of examine the phenomenon of people like ganging up and doing these like real life bullying things. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty interesting. Like they talk about something I'd never heard of. This kid.
Well, who is that bullying? Like the dude who was hungry for imitation crab and to like jack off and pretend he's Godzilla.
Yeah, No. I'm not trying to classify it all as bullying. I mean, there's obviously some stuff that's like amazingly hilarious, awesome internet content, and then stuff that crosses the line because they were talking about this teenage kid who had killed himself, and they were going through this kid's MySpace page and saw that he had posted about someone stealing his iPod. And so everyone on 4chan had decided, oh, he killed himself because someone stole his iPod. And they started making all of these photoshops about it and stuff. And people started like calling the dude's family about
it. That stuff's fucked up.
That's an entirely different thing.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, I'm serious. I'm not just like saying that like smirking. I think that's garbage, you know. I think it's totally different.
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds like an interesting story. I want to read it. Someone did send her out a link. But that's so different than like making up the story of this guy who actually doesn't exist, but who's got his kid's model railroad train and he's just like hungry for a little J.O. and a crap.
We all know the difference between goofing off and actual bullying and griefing. So I think. I hope.
Let it be known.
Nevertheless, I still feel like talking about Zoo Tycoon.
You know what? We waste all this time.
Something a little more wholesome.
Talking about all that shit, but I was like, I meant to ask Robert about the Spore prototype stuff, but.
But instead, we wasted this time.
Yeah, I'm sorry. That was another story that just went up on our site. The site being oneup.com.
Hey, you should read it.
It's still on. If you go to the PC or GFW doors, you can still see it on there. So, but it's, I'll let you run it down.
It's just about how. From a couple weeks ago until the release of Spore, they're going to, for promotional purposes and just for people who are interested, release a bunch of prototypes that the Spore team made when they were sort of in the conceptualization stage of Spore. And it's cool because they're not exactly like games. I mean, actually, the two that they have up right now are really kind of hard to understand. Software programs that are sort of made to simulate things that they were thinking about simulating in the game. But it's pretty interesting to see what they were considering putting into the game. Because one of the prototypes is called Particle Man, and it was this sort of way to test this idea that one of the designers had that players should be able to build planets by by sort of sculpting them, like a, sort of like a potter's wheel. So you make your own planet by like going out to where there's a bunch of stardust and sort of spinning the dust around until you get like an interesting shape, you know. And it was this weird way to try to incorporate real physics into making a planet. Mm-hmm. And obviously it didn't make it into the final game. And so they put this out there as just showing what one of the many things that they were considering doing in the game. Because it seems to me like that at some point they thought about simulating practically everything in the whole fucking universe
game. That's how they pitched it, yeah. You know, yeah. 3 years ago or whatever. Sim everything.
Right.
They definitely had to cut back on that.
A little ambitious.
Yeah, just a little bit. But it's pretty interesting stuff. I get the feeling they'll probably put several more up before the game comes out.
Probably will, yeah.
Yeah.
Sean Malloy and I saw a bunch of that when we went to see Sims 3. So I don't know if this is just something that this particular team or group of developers does, but it was really interesting to see where Rod Humble, the head of the Sims department, who was on our podcast a little while ago, had the whole Sims 3 team, everybody on the team, do prototypes based on a certain human interaction that they felt they wanted to pursue in Sims 3, which was socialization. So they had everybody just do whatever. It could be anything. And they all came up with different little kind of mini games or whatever that was sort of their idea of what socialization was about. So it was pretty neat, and we got to play some of them. So it's sort of a cool insight just to see what's going on in these guys' heads.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting that like most of the time when you get to see a game that's in the works, you usually see something that represents what you'll be playing.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool for them to release something for you to play around with that is so early that it's almost unrecognizably part of Spore, you know. Mm-hmm. It's really an early, early part of their creative process. Mm-hmm. And sort of audacious to catalog it. It's like, we're going to provide you with the history of Spore. I mean, it adds to this sense like that Spore is this mega event, and we've even got it documented for you, you know?
I hope they beat the declining hype, because I definitely get the feeling that game is on the downside of its hype curve.
I
think that coming out of E3, I feel like there's a real sense that the game isn't going to deliver on the promises that it delivered, you know, it made 3 weeks ago or 6 months ago or 3 years ago. And, you know, I want to be completely blown away by it. You know, maybe what they're doing is lowering my expectations so that when it comes out,
I thought
I'll
we already had
away.
The backlash, and now it was the backlash of the backlash.
I think
I thought we are back into it. What's the current
meme? Where's the hypometer?
Yeah. What am I supposed to think? Sean, you're more of a believer now? Is that what you were going to say?
Yeah, I think that it's – I mean, we faced something similar like right before GTA 4 came out, where there was like – I remember Robert and I were specifically having this conversation. We're like, does anyone care? And you're like, you know what? It doesn't matter, because I guarantee you the week will come when the game's going to be released and we're going to run to the store.
Yeah, exactly.
But I think in this case it's like – yeah, you're right. If it's like diminishing the hype that was established 3 years ago is big, but the hype from 6 months ago, I think that they're pretty much 6 months ago presenting an accurate like representation of how the game's actually going to be. But even like on this, it's not even anecdotal evidence. It's armature traffic evidence, and like based on, you know, we put up a story that will say, here are these creatures created in the Spore engine and stuff. And sadly, you know, I'm always talking about the great features we do. It's like it's got like, you know, 50 times the traffic of anything, and it continues week after week to be popular. And it's like, maybe it's because it's just a kind of story that's it's very easy to click through. You don't have to invest anything other than the ability to hit your scroll wheel and look at like cute pictures. But
it doesn't require actual reading and intelligence.
Yeah, but I think though that like that interest is there. When it comes out, everyone will be talking about it. And I mean, putting the creature creator out just caused like another big, you know, bout of discussion.
That's actually what re-upped the hype for me, was actually seeing what people were making. Was like, okay, the creativity really is here.
Oh,
it's like outrageous what people are doing.
I mean, my 8-year-old daughter is addicted to the creature creator. I mean, she's got a library of 100 crazy ass things I never could have come up with. But I still feel like we haven't seen the game all the way through.
That's true.
Right? I mean,
we have not.
We've seen lots of little pieces that look really cool.
Yeah, I have no idea.
I still really want to feel how you, when you sit down and you want to play for 30 hours over the course of a long game, I don't know what the hell that even looks like.
You're right.
You know, I know all the pieces look really freaking cool.
I've seen, I can imagine it just because I played in like bits and pieces in you know, some of the different like stages. There's the 5 stages of the game. And I don't imagine anyone would play for 5 hours consecutively with the game unless they like spend a lot of that time messing with the creature editor and things like that. But I think like, I don't know, maybe it's going to go through this period where it's going to come out. Everyone's going to talk about like, oh my God, like, have you got it? Like, everyone's going to want to just like, there's this phase of the post-release where everyone's going to like, I'm part of this. I have something to say about it. I played it too. And it's going to be celebrating the diversity of possible creations. And I think next is going to be this phase of like, just like you had GTA, when GTA 4 came out, it's like, here's my GTA story. It's like, tell your, like, what's the, who's got the campaign right now? It's like, tell us your story. And it's like, it's basically advertising something, but you like, I don't know. Maybe someone will recognize that. But it's some current ad campaign for some non-game related product. But
I don't know. I don't look
like,
at ads.
This is what happened. I did.
You only watch PBS.
So what
I don't play MMOs. I don't look at ads.
So, but
I only listen to classical music.
In that phase, I imagine people will be saying things like, "Oh my God, I ran into the creature that I created in like the tribal stage on like another planet in this whole other system." But I also remember the time when This ship just came down and abducted me, and it all made sense because then I recognized that same ship on that planet, and they kept the details, and everyone will have all these stories. Then a couple months after that, people will start saying, hey, wasn't this the one where that fucking dude in the glasses was telling me I'd be able to like make planets and all this stuff, you know, and like I could, you know, change the salinity of water and all these other, you know, all these other variables and stuff. And then they'll start to feel like, well, it's fun, creature creator, but where's all these other promises?
Right.
And like, and then that'll. I think that's just the natural cycle of the way that games come out now.
Yeah, although for sport is a particularly hard sort of tack back to game, because for years they talked about it like they were doing like serious research into the nature of the universe or something.
No. I don't think they ever
did
that.
Think they were.
Oh, sure they did.
No, man.
Will Wright's TED presentations? Absolutely. He's talking about creating tools to learn about how things are made. I mean, he totally hyped it
really?
That way,
I mean,
a couple
years
ago.
But I don't think he said that's
it's
what the game
hype,
was
going to
do. That's like what they were doing on their end while they were making the game.
I definitely don't see it as hype. I think they honestly have this weird creative process where they look at the natural world and they're really interested in science and the way the universe works and say, what can we take from this and turn it into a video game? And the first thing they think is like, oh, let's do everything.
Right.
And
but doesn't Miyamoto do that too, like to some extent? Like I've read stories about him getting ideas from like gardening.
Yeah.
Like that, you
know? Although like in the story that
slightly different outcome.
Well, yeah.
In the story I just read, I pointed out what a big difference that it is actually between like the way Miyamoto does things and the way that like Will Wright does things. Because you look at Miyamoto and like he will famously create a game where it's all about like, you know, like when Mario 64 was in development, he had his designers build this little garden where he played around with Mario's moves and design moves and just played with the way he moved before he designed anything else. It was all about the tactile experience of playing Mario. So it was, you know, creating a world out of play. Whereas with Spore, you've got this thing where they look at the world and try to create play from the real world.
Yeah.
Right.
But anyway.
Right.
That's something else about. Oh, yeah. You know what's the other. It's almost unfortunate is that now, since Will and Maxis have talked at such a length about their game, imagine if it had been reversed where the game comes out and you're playing it for the first time and you're realizing for yourself as you're playing that the game is sort of mimicking the history of video game development, you know, where it starts off with something on the level of Pac-Man and it moves up, and we've heard this over and over again, and introduces, you know, the equivalent of like Civ games and all these other things, and basically working its way up to, you know, the sim everything. I mean, it's like, if we took it home and we played it and we experienced that for ourselves, I think that would be really like fascinating and really impressive.
That would be like,
you know,
earth shattering.
Yeah,
I mean,
but
if
it's
it
like
really
now,
came out of nowhere,
it's like,
you know,
we've heard it so many times, and this is potentially one of the coolest structural, you know, aspects of the game. And it's just like, it's been like 3 years now that people have been writing about that element of the game.
Right. Well, somebody asked me on a forum, on our forum, in a question thread about like, did I feel like personally that this cycle of publicity, the way these things work over multi-years, if that ultimately, you know, ends up being a detriment or hurting the company and the game in question. And I think it probably usually does, right? This like multi-year buildup of hype and the going dark and coming back. You know, yeah, I mean, imagine, you're right. What if all we knew about Spore was that there was this creature creator, and then maybe the next stage
And then when it came out, it turned out it did all the, right. you know, it kept well, going and going and going.
But
like
we've
how
seen,
blown away
we've seen
we
how that feels in a small scale. I mean, that's how we all felt about Portal, right? None
yeah,
of us knew
right.
anything about
that's
it.
That's right.
And then, boom, it was like, here's this awesome thing that you've never even heard of.
That
I think
was a great
I wish all
them.
Games sure. were like that.
Right.
I mean, I wish, like, the first time I'd heard about Diablo 3 was because it launched this week, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that would be great.
Yeah, yeah.
Wouldn't that – we'd all just be talking about it for months.
Right.
I just don't know if that's practical, though, because I think that people do use, like, the feedback from the public to change aspects of a game.
Yeah. Like they're making Diablo
but
darker.
But, Julian, I mean, you're right. But Portal is, like, that's a, just a great example. I mean, and look what it did. Like, we ended up giving it Game of the Year ourselves at GFW.
And that and that's a game, though, that would have been absolutely ruined by knowing anything about it.
Yes.
You know, like – I think some games can stand up somewhat. Mm-hmm. Like, it is a shame that they let the cat out of the bag in Spore about this sort of cool idea of it tracing the history of games. Like, that would have been something neat to just experience. But for the most part, like, learning about, you know, the basic mechanics of a game doesn't tend to take away mm-hmm. from it, in my opinion.
And I think there's some other Easter eggs about Spore that aren't completely out yet.
There's got
it. All now ruined.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure there will be.
Yeah. There toward the ending of the game, we know there's some.
Right.
Like, in the past, I think this – I mean, well, for one, more and more companies are basically taking the exact course that we're talking about. It was kind of one that, like, Activision really proved worked well with Call of Duty 4 last year.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, I think that the fact that this is happening in the internet age even intensifies this sort of burnout cycle because, I mean, a few different reasons. You can be held to every single word you had. So say if you're, like, you know, you're Dennis Dyack or something, people are already doing that to him. You know, you make a claim about your game. It could be years ago or whatever. People dig that up with, like, two keystrokes, and, like, there it is all of a sudden,
right.
word for word. There's your face in a video saying these things. People can bring up the YouTubes of Will Wright and stuff and then immediately put those out. And it's, like, maybe that's, like, someone's first encounter. Maybe,
yeah.
like, this month someone's being introduced to Spore by seeing that very first, you know, GDC video with Will Wright or something. And so that, I think, just complicates it, you know, and makes people more aware of, you know, what they've been told and what they're receiving.
Right. Yeah, I blame Derek Smart. It's all his fault.
All everything.
It all started with Derek Smart. No,
really?
the whole endless hype cycle.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he's the cautionary tale of telling anybody about your game.
Was his fiasco,
or making one.
Was yes. his before Daikatana?
Yeah. Yeah. He
yeah.
goes back to Usenet.
He's the
original Usenet flame war starter.
Battle cruiser.
Yeah.
Just got a shiver down my spine.
Yeah. Those were good old days. Are we at the end of our show, Skip, do you think?
Skip wants to go home.
Yeah.
He wants to get out of here. Don't blame it on – don't start that shit. We're done because we're done. We're done because we're tired. There's no one kicking us out. Skip was cool enough to hang around for us.
Thank you, Skip.
Don't be angry
letting
at anyone.
Talk.
That's it.
Ryan, any final words?
None.
Well, thank you guys for having me.
Thank you, Julian. Sorry. You're welcome back. Anytime. If you're a GFW Radio fan, I encourage you to also listen to Gamers with Jobs. That's gamerswithjobs.com. They have a great podcast over there, so go check that out. Dr. Max Chill, a pleasure as always.
Thank you. I greatly enjoyed today's podcast.
Well, now we know what you're a doctor of, at least. Xenobiology.
All right.
Just like Will Wright.
All right. All right, we'll be back next week.